Don't you know that I'm loving you? In a god of a feet, oh baby. Don't you know that I'll always be true?
Well, thanks for coming over, dude.
Thank
Cheers.
You. Thank you.
Have you done your coffee already? Straight Almost. Down the hatch. So I guess Wales is where I want the story to begin. My mum's from Brecon, or Talgar. Where were you born? You were born in Wales, right?
I was. I was born in Ystrad Munich, which is a little mining village just north of Cardiff. So I left, as you can hear from my accent.
You didn't stay long.
I wasn't. I think my first words were in a Welsh accent, but after that, we moved to America in 1967, so I was about 2 years old, and we're this little Welsh mining family that emigrated to Atlanta, Georgia in the late 60s, so it was a bit like, I think for my parents, it was like landing on the moon.
I'll bet. I mean, I imagine at that time, not many people were leaving Wales to go to the States.
No, I mean, it was, I traveled around, I moved around a bunch, and even I remember in the 70s moving around, and that was strange, but in the 60s, to travel from England or from Wales and to live in Atlanta was literally like moving to the moon. I mean, you knew you weren't going to see your family for even, you know, a couple of years or whatever, and, you know, we didn't have any of these things we have now, so it was just crazy, and of course, the world, I mean, you know, when I hear my parents' stories, I mean, it was, my parents, the first day my mom dressed my brother and I in wool, like, you know, the kind of thing you dress kids back in those days.
Yeah, yeah.
Wool trousers, wool, and sweaters, and it was probably like 100% humidity, 98 degrees, Atlanta in the late spring. I mean, crazy. I mean, it was just
taking that Welsh fashion over.
And she couldn't drive. So we were walking. I'm literally walking from the motel to pick up, because I think they put them in a motel to start with, into a shop. Like a mile and a half, just cars driving by, this woman with two kids dressed in wool suits.
You must have looked like aliens to everyone else, right?
Yeah, it was nuts. I think it was just nuts. Yeah.
What did your folks do? What drove them to want to migrate over there?
I think my mother always wanted to.
That nice and close to your mouth as well.
Here you go. I know, especially with my mother, she just always wanted to get out of the valleys. I think she had aspirations, and this opportunity came up. My dad was an engineer, and he had done well. And both of their grandparents were miners. So they were both underground at the age of 14.
Yeah.
You know, and up until they retired. And my dad did well enough in school that he didn't have to be a miner, which was a huge thing back in those days. And he went on and did, got his degrees, worked in the UK for a bit. And then got in the late 60s, Vietnam War was, or mid 60s, late 60s, Vietnam War was raging. And they needed engineers to help basically build shit to kill people, really, mm-hmm. ultimately, airplanes and things. My dad was an aeronautical engineer, and so and the best engineers at that time were over here. So they recruited a bunch of them, and my dad got this job offer that he kind of couldn't refuse. Kind of wanted to refuse, because he was much more of a, you know,
he was a home kind of guy, was he?
Really, yeah. I think his whole life he did, really. But
did they have a television?
The story goes, there's sort of an apocryphal story in my family that when he sent the letter of acceptance, he put it on a string on it and put it in the post so he could still pull it out if he changed his mind. I don't know if that's really true or not. But so that's what really drove him over there. He had this opportunity, and they went, and it was to build bombers, I think, at Lockheed, which was based in Atlanta, just outside Atlanta. In 67, I think. And we were there for like a year, and then we moved to North Carolina.
Have you got brothers and sisters?
I do. At that time, just a brother who was older. And so he was old enough that it was quite a big event for him, because I think he's 7 years older than me. So he was about 10. And, you know, obviously a very, just a little Welsh kid. And he was suddenly in this school in Atlanta, Georgia. And the story he always tells is it was his first day, and he was spinning out, you know, just completely couldn't understand anybody, and you know, they couldn't understand him. And the teacher was like, so you want to go to the restroom? And he was thinking, oh, thank God. Thinking there'd be this room with like couches and shit that he could just rest in. So they sent him down the hall, and then he walks into a bog. He's like, what the fuck? So yeah, I think it was really tough on him, but you know, we all benefited from it ultimately. And then I have a little sister, but she was born in the States a couple of years later.
And you moved around a lot in the States, am I thinking?
I did. I moved around, I mean, basically, you know, not to bore people, but then we moved to North Carolina over there for quite a few years. And then I actually moved to Birmingham over here.
In the UK?
Yeah, wow. When I was 11. So I lived there for a few years. And, wow. Which was great, a great experience. And that's why I'm a Birmingham City supporter.
So nice. Go.
Sticks with you.
Always good to have Brummies on the show.
And then... and then from there, we moved to Nashville, Tennessee, which was a dramatic experience. Yeah, when I did the Nashville one, man, that was tough because it was in the mid-70s, and I had a Brummie accent at that point. And honestly, they really did think I'd come from the moon. I mean, it's not like today where everybody sees TV. We're all used to, like, you know, different cultures back then, honestly.
Yeah, there was no Ozzy Osbourne.
Nah.
Well, I guess he was around. But...
He was around, but, you know, in Nashville in 1977 or whatever it was. They were like, yeah. So, yeah, and then we just moved around a bunch more, and I ended up after university, I was in New York for a little bit and just running wild, and I knew I needed to kind of... Actually, one of the big things, I just knew I needed to be a better actor. So I got accepted to drama school here, thank God. I applied to, like, everyone. Got one, finally took me. And I went there, I came to London, and ever since then I've basically been back and forth. You know, I live in sometimes in the States for long periods, but try and make London my home whenever I can.
Do you even concern yourself with stuff like this, but do you identify as American, as British, as a bit of both?
A bit of both. It depends which part I'm up for.
Yeah, right. Smart man.
In truth, I am more British, really. The way we were brought up, just, you know, we had Sunday dinners. It was all like Sunday lunch kind of thing. We, you know, the humor of my family. Even though we were living in America all that time, I was, you know, we were always very, very British in my house. And then we used to come here a lot, like every summer for quite a lot of years. And so it's always been very, I always knew I'd come back here. I think some part of me knew that I would end up spending most of my adult life living here. But when I'm here a long time, I miss America. Like I like, there's something about the space of it, the certain convenience of it that I like. So I can't be without either one. It's a weird thing. Like, I can't be in one place. Like, if I'm in LA for too long, I go nuts. I need to come back here. I need the compactness of this city. I need the culture. I need the people. I need the diversity of it. You know, there's something, you know, that I miss when I'm there. So it's like I'm really a hybrid. I mean, I am pure hybrid of the two. But if I had to literally choose one, I'd say ultimately I'm British, even though I sound like this.
And luckily you have the trade that allows you to jump back and forth.
Yeah, exactly.
And integrate both cultures.
And what's nice is the business has changed a lot in that way, because when I started as an actor, it was very hard to get seen for British roles, even though I'd be like, I'm Welsh, whatever, you know, they would, you know, you were only seen from, like, if you had an accent like mine, or they even got a hint that you did, you were never seen for anything other than, you know, American roles over here. And the problem is they were, you know, this limits you so much. So I was determined. I mean, you know, I'm not bad at accents, and I can do Welsh. I can do, you know, things. And I'd always wanted to do much more British stuff. It's really hard. But what's happened now, because TV's become so much more international. Mm-hmm. Even Game of Thrones was a big game changer in that. We had American actors, you know, doing, in varying degrees, but generally pretty decent British accents, you know. And it's more and more of that that, you know, we get seen, you know, that it's not so like, if you're from, you know, it used to be almost like if you're from, only did Liverpool, if you're from Liverpool, you know, they're so specific. And don't ask me to do that. You know, I mean, I'll leave that Stephen Graham.
I had Stephen Graham on the podcast.
Yeah, I heard it.
His accent
podcast.
When he's just being himself is like Scouse turned up to 11.
I know. It's amazing. If you ever want to like learn the Scouse accent, I'm just going to listen to
that. Study him.
But so that's me. So, you know, I play both, which is great, you know, and I get to, you know, do do bits and bobs playing, either, someone from Britain or someone from America, obviously a lot of American stuff because I do a lot of work over there too. But, that's really been great. But what's been so great is how that's changed. And that may be partly because my work has changed and, people know me a bit more now. But, yeah.
It's a fascinating career trajectory and journey that you've had. And I want to talk first of all about the school of drama that you studied at in London. It was under a guy called Sam, what was the teacher's name?
Cogan. And yeah, very radical.
Eddie Marsden studied there with you as well, right?
Eddie's my best mate. Yeah, he's like, literally the expression, he's like my brother, which people use all the time in America. Yeah, he's my brother, In this case, it's really, really very, very true. We talk like every day. But he, we actually went to another school first, which Mount View, which is now in South London, I think, but used to be up in Wood Green, Wood Green. And it was crazy back in those days. So we were there for 3 years. So Eddie and I studied there together, and that's where we first met. It's funny, it's crazy. Now you look back and it's just, there's probably like a handful of us still doing it, left. We're still in the profession. But there was a teacher, we were so lucky while we were there for the 3 years we were there, Sam was a teacher there. They hired him and he was amazing, man.
When studied, you say he was like a radical guy, what was his science of acting?
Less like radical now, but back, and we're going back to like 19, I think Eddie and I started in 88. So, 88 to 91 or whatever it was. And back in those days, sort of drama, and people are probably going, that's not really true. But back, at least in the majority of drama schools now, I know there were, there was Drama Center was quite well known as being very radical and methody. And, the kind of Mount View, some very traditional drama schools were, the way they taught was still kind of very, they're kind of steered clear of too methody type stuff, too much Stanislavski. You still got to like find your center and, speak clearly and, very kind of RSC type acting. So they hired this guy, Sam. He was just a teacher. He didn't have his own school or anything at this point. And I think another school did as well in London. I had him teaching there, but we were incredibly blessed because he was only there 3 years. I mean, they fired him ultimately because he was just creating so much, like a cult really around it because he was the best teacher there. He was amazing. And he studied at the Moscow Arts Theater himself. He's a Russian. And he had basically developed the Stanislavski theory further himself. So he'd come up a lot with his own ideas developing it, but basically it was Stanislavski. So we were, it was just an incredible stroke of luck that Eddie and I had him, but he was a huge impact to both of us, really. We were like, some people hated him. Some of the students just couldn't get it, but Eddie and I loved him and others as well. And he was amazing. And so once we left drama school, Eddie and I continued to study with him. Because I think one of the things, if there's like any young actors, who are Rob Zombie fans have tuned into this. And, one of the things I would say that why Eddie is still working and why I think I'm still working is because when we left school, we just still studied. We still did every shit play you could get. The number of times I saw Eddie in a fringe theater with three other people watching it, or Eddie saw me in some dingy fringe theater with, two people watching it, we could count on all of our fingers, tons of stuff we did. Because both of us knew, it's like a process of learning. It's not like so many people I went to school, or a lot of people I know I went to school with, just thought, that's it. I graduated, now bring it. Give me the
I'm fully formed, I'm ready to go.
And that's bullshit. It's like, I knew I had a lot of learning still to do. I'd gone to university, had studied acting there. I went to New York for a year. I studied with some great teachers in New York. One of them, Beatrice Strait, who was, have you ever seen Network?
No.
If you get a chance, well, it's a great film to begin with. But
so she was an actress as well, yeah?
Really famous, like an older actress, British actress, older woman. By the time I met her, she was well in her 80s, I think.
Wow, and still teaching.
Yeah, and still working. I mean, she's an amazing woman. She was Michael Chekhov, who's another Russian teacher. She had studied with him, so it was a studio in New York, and she taught taught me for a year. And she was, she's amazing. But oh, network. Yeah. To be careful, you got to put me back on track.
It's all good. That's why I'm
Network is definitely worth checking out, because she won the Academy Award for Best Supporting Actress that year, like in the 70s, 76, something like that, for the shortest scene. She's only got one scene, I believe. It's when, like, I think it's Peter Finch finds out he's having an affair or something like that. But it's just this amazing scene. But that one scene, she wins an Academy Award for. It's the least amount of time someone's been on screen and they still win an Oscar. So she was amazing. So anyway, I studied with her. I went to Mount View. And even then, I was like, I still wanted to learn more. I know I can be better. I could be real. I can be more, just better. Shit, I could just be better. And so
you still feel like that now?
I always think like that. Yeah. All the time. So we studied with Sam, and then it was, and you know, did a bunch there as well. And then just kept doing it. And I always feel like I can be better. Always learning. I mean, now it's like learning on the job, you know.
Yeah. The best training school.
Yeah, it really has been. I mean, that's why doing all those fringe theaters were great, you know. And also, you can be really shit and nobody sees it, which is great, because that's how you want to
get it out your system,
yeah.
Right?
I mean, it's hard now for a young actor who makes it really quickly, because then maybe the next film, you know, they really take a risk and it doesn't work, and then that's it, you know. So for Eddie and I, we were lucky. We were able to be shit, and like, you know, 12 people saw it.
And thank God. And there's no internet then, so it's not on YouTube somewhere.
Exactly.
Like,
yeah. Right.
I watched your first ever film the other day, Death Machine. Classic,
right.
Kind of cyberpunk.
Yeah.
The character you play is called Scott Ridley. Is that a kind of a homage to Ridley Scott?
Yeah.
Was that the thinking?
If you look
there?
All the characters' names of that, there's like one's Carpenter. After John Carpenter.
Of course, yeah.
I forget the others, but I think all the names pretty much were plays on different directors.
And how old are you when you made that? You're like 30?
I was not even. I turned 30 when I moved to LA, I think. So it was 93 we filmed that. So I was 28, going to turn 29 almost. So that was an amazing, that was my first kind of film.
Mm.
In fact, it was like my first job where I was actually making some, you
and
know,
it's a pretty significant role.
Yeah, it was weird. I mean, it was, you know, it was interesting because, and it sort of a foreshadowed in a way what happened to me and next really, because it was a role that was like, he was head of this cyber corporation or whatever, right? So really, if you had the budget, you got Christopher Walken. You need someone who's like, who was probably like 45 at that time or something. You need like a 45-year-old guy to play that role. But obviously this was a low, you know, this is British filmmaking at its finest in the 90s. It was great independent film time, by the way, of that stuff. There's some Richard Stanley. Have you ever heard of that guy?
Yeah.
Yeah, you know, I loved all that. So, you know, they didn't have any money, really. They had just enough to get Brad Dourif, you know, and
he's fantastic.
Amazing, man. I want to go. I'll go there in a sec. But, and so, you know, I auditioned for it, and then I auditioned again, met the director, and, you know, we did the scenes together, and then I got offered it. But, you know, for me, it was great because that was the kind of roles that I would eventually, I knew that those roles I could play, but I knew I was still a bit young. I was like 28. I wasn't pretty enough to be the leading men in films, but I wasn't really old enough to play the characters that I knew I could play. So I had this thing that if I can just hang in there, you know, when my hair really does recede, you know, when I do start to look like these guys really well, you know, I knew that because I knew I'd be uglier and uglier as I got older and older, that, you know, that things might pick up, you know, because it was tough, you know, it's tough when you're a young actor, period. But it's particularly tough if you're kind of a character actor sometimes. And, so yeah, it was great. It was it was an amazing experience.
When you arrive in the film, I initially thought you're going to be the villain because you're this kind of sleazy business type, and then Brad rolls in,
yeah.
And you're like, oh no, that's the villain. And people listen to this, if they don't know him, I guess he's probably most famous for playing Wormtongue in Lord of the Rings, but he was, of course, in One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest.
Won an Oscar for that.
And Billy Bibbit, was that the character's name?
Yeah.
And Child's Play, all the Chucky films. But I mean, you get one real kind of key scene together in Death Machine.
Yeah, which was so much fun.
He's just off the wall, isn't he?
Yeah, and he's kind of, he's so intense. And like, that was my first experience working with an actor at that level. I mean, I had, you know, done Jeeves and Worcester basically chasing around Stephen Fry, but you know, I hadn't actually really, there wasn't anything proper in that. But actually doing a scene with an actor with that much experience, you know, was, well, again, a real learning thing for me, because he was so focused. Like the focus he had coming on the whole time was incredible. And really generous guy, no attitude, you know, just eat. Because when you're young, you know, you're terrified of these guys. I was like, is he going to be? Because he's also so kind of wacky, too. You think he's going to be? I mean, he's a little wacky, but that's because, you know, he is wacky, and that's, you can see that in his work. It's a good, fun wacky. It's a good wacky. But I was really lucky that my first experience with a kind of Hollywood actor was him, because he's just a great guy. And then I got to see him again.
Halloween 2, right?
You're yeah, both in that. We were in that together, and I don't think we had any scenes together, but we were both in Atlanta at the same time filming that. So we went out to dinner, him and I, and
amazing,
another actor. It was just great to chat, you know, and
reminisce.
Catch up with him. I think he's a great actor too.
Amazing.
I mean, he got, you know, caught up in the whole horror world and stuff, but if you go back to his early work and things, you know, he's genius.
And then after that film, it's kind of like a dry spell for quite a long time, right? And I guess you've alluded to why earlier, because
there wasn't, you know, I mean, the truth story is that how much time do we have?
Is it like a string?
I mean, honestly, people are going to have to fast forward.
I've got all the time in the world.
I cannot listen to these man's stories, man. But yeah, basically what happened was unless you're like a diehard Richard Brake fan. But they basically what happened then was I suddenly decided I'm going to be a movie star, right? As every young guy, you do a film and you're like, this is it, man. I am going to LA. So what happened to me was around the time we were filming that, friend of mine was doing the Discovery Channel. So they were putting together some documentary, or they had put together a documentary for D-Day, because it was like 40th something anniversary or whatever it was, 50th something. Anyway, and so they were taking this documentary to sell in Cannes at the TV festival. And at the stand, they were going to have actors reenacting daily things of soldiers in D-Day. So like cleaning their boots or whatever, right? So they hired my mate and some other actors. And my mate called me and said, look, you know, if you want, this is a good pay, you know. And at the time, I'm like literally trying to make my rent. I'm going, he's like, yeah, it's like, you know, whatever it was. You want to come do this? And we get a free trip to Cannes. And I'm like 28. I'm like, shit, yeah, it's great. So I said, yeah, I'm in. So basically did that. We went to Cannes. It was the best time I've ever had, by the way. It was so much fun. I mean, it's such a laugh. But we did this thing. And they loved it so much. They're like, yeah, come to Anaheim in November, December, whatever it was, because there's another convention. We're going to fly you guys. We're like, oh, we're going to L.A. So I thought, well, fuck it. It's a ticket to L.A. And I had no real, you know, I had a girlfriend, bless her, who I just basically said, who became my wife. But, and now it's my ex-wife. But I said, I'm moving to L.A. You know, I mean, she's like, I mean, that's kind of unfair, really. And I just packed my belongings, which fit into a box pretty much at that point, and mailed it to my sister's or wherever she lives in America, and then got that ticket and didn't use return. So we moved, so flew to Anaheim. I remember it was my birthday, November 93. And then I moved to LA and ended up living there for like 5 years. So
just going for auditions, going for parts.
Yeah, I mean, I got there and, you know, it's an eye-opener. You know, it was crazy. It was like, I would not recommend it. Like if a young actor says to me, oh, I think, you know, I just did and they do, like people, not even young people, like, you know, people have been around a little bit, go, oh, I just had a great part on, you know, whatever. And I'm thinking of moving to LA. And I'm like, yeah, I'd wait. It's a good, one of the best things that I've heard is the saying, wait till they want you, which I think is, you know, if you're an actor over here, you know, it's better to wait, you know, because there's such a feel like, oh, it's all happening there. But, you know, I had a British American passport. I, you know, my accent's like this. So I thought, you know, I'm going to do it. And I had Death Machine in the can, right?
Yep.
So I go there. I get an agent. You know, I want whatever, UT Air 8, whatever the big ones. I end up with like the sweetest guy in the world, but he retired after like 3 years to go do his real passion, which is photography. I mean, he was just, you know, his mother was the one helping him in the office. I mean, it was literally like a one man show. And I would just go out to auditions, and it was crazy. It would be like two lines in. I remember one was for some Arnold Schwarzenegger film, and my agent called me. He goes, "You got to get down to," it was like Universal or somewhere or wherever it was, "Warner Brothers. You got to get down to Warner Brothers now. They've just fired the guy who has the opening line in." I wish I could remember the movie, but it was some Schwarzenegger thing, right? And it's like, and the opening line was the name of the film. So it's something like, you slam the door, your policeman slam the door and you go, "Gotcha." You know, the film was called something like that.
Yeah. I mean,
somebody will be able to Google and figure out which Schwarzenegger film. It was about 96, Evan. You know, so I get in my car, you know, I'm driving like breakneck speed to Warner Brothers, get on the lot. You know, I have to, it's during filming because they've literally just fired the guy and they need to hire somebody that day to shoot the scene. You know, and I'm waiting and there's like 20 other guys pacing around and we all go into the director's trailer and literally wait, I go in the trailer, director goes, "Okay, do it." You know, I get up there, way over the top, slam the door, "Gotcha." He's like, "Take it down a little, you know, gotcha." Drive home, hear nothing. You know, it was like one after the other, those kind of things. And
that's tough, right? Because you've got, as you say, you've got to live, you've got to exist,
honestly,
you've got to pay rent.
And you just realize the sheer number of actors, you know, and you know, you've pad your CV with all the fringe shows you've done, and you make yourself sound like you're the next Jeremy Irons or something, so that you look really RSC, you know, and all that. And they don't give a shit. You know, they just want, do you look, you know, you, how do you look? Are you handsome, young? And like I said earlier, I wasn't good looking enough to go play the handsome guy in, you know, Geeks and Freaks or whatever. And I wasn't
old enough to be.
And not really characterful. Like, my face became so much more characterful as I got older. Teeth got all mangled. I mean, it's just like, I mean, I've just been blessed.
There's so
with
many
this
great close
of,
ups of your teeth in so many films.
I know, because it's weird. It's just sort of like I have
like
wisdom
your
teeth that came in and they've sort of just mangled my front teeth. And I've never, you know, but in fact, I digress for a sec. I once went and had my, after I did Hannibal Rising, my mom was like, "Oh, you need to really get your teeth whitened, you know, I'll pay for it to get whitened." I'm like, "No, you have to pay for it." My mom's like, No. So I went and had my teeth whitened, like really properly, like really well done over here somewhere. And, didn't get another job for like 6 months. So I start, I thought, it's because I whitened my teeth. Yep. I know. And everyone's going, "You look great." You know, they didn't know. I was like, "Yeah, no, I'm never whitening my teeth." But yeah, so it was brutal. It was
what
really
were you doing
tough.
For money?
Well, it was tough. I mean, this will tell you what happened to me. And this is what the reason why there's that gap. Because a lot of people say, because I think that
it's like almost
Wikipedia,
10 years,
somebody
right?
wrote, I think it was more like, maybe it's that much. I'm not sure. But so basically, I was doing whatever I could. And one of them I remember is a friend of mine had like a vending machine business. And the vending machine business is very, it's a gangstery thing going on there. And I don't think my friend was too gangstery, though. He may have been, I don't know. But there's definitely like, contracts that are, you know, there's a lot of things. So he said, "Look, I need you to, can you cold call these leads I've got?" And he had like 1,000, you know, like 10,000 leads that he purchased of like car dealerships throughout Southern California. And I basically sat in an office on my own with these cars. He goes, "I'll pay you, you know, $4 an hour. And every time you get me a contract, you know, I'll give you whatever." So, and I would just call these, but you know, it was like, you're always calling these car dealers who are in a gangster thing. And they'd just be like, "Oh, fuck off, man. If you're not," and I was just abused day in and day out of this abuse from these guys. And I was just being worn down, you know, but I was like trying to make what I could get, just survived to go to some damn audition to do one line in a film that I'd probably only get, you know, a couple grand for if I'm lucky, but at least I'll pay the rent. And then what happened was I was in, my mother had come to visit me in L.A. And she was a really successful woman. And later in life, she had decided to open an antique store importing British antiques. furniture from mostly pine, well, almost entirely British antique pine, which was really big in the States.
Is this just again pre-internet, so you can't get access to stuff
right,
like that?
Right, right. It was, you know, you couldn't. It was definitely way pre-internet. It was. She really started in the early '80s, but wow. By the mid '80s, they had moved to Connecticut, which was kind of very sort of New England-y. You know, there was a lot of Anglophiles,
yeah.
And she had opened a little shop there, and that just took off like unbelievable, right? And then she expanded into a much bigger shop, and she became the biggest importer of antique pine in the U.S. I mean, she was just massive, right? And she had done this really all on her own. I mean, it was incredible, really. And she was in her 50s when she started. So, you know, anybody looking, you know, for inspiration, you can start anytime, do what you want. Because she loved that kind of stuff, so she loved it. And my sister had just divorced, and she was looking for something. So my mom was out, and she goes, you know, you could, I can help you guys start up a branch of this shop, Prince of Wales, it was called, and your sister can help run it with you, and because you know that would be great. You two can run it. It can be, you know, your thing. And I was like, yeah, you know, I started thinking, because by this point I was burnt out with talking to car dealers,
beating
getting
down.
Screamed at. I mean, I was just. I used to drive to this guy's in the valley, in L.A. You go
yeah,
over
yeah.
the hill, right? I was living in Beverly Hills. I call poor man's Beverly Hills because it's like the flats bit, but
yeah.
It just happened literally on the border of. But I just found an apartment there that was reasonable price. So I was there and I'd drive over the hill. And then it was just this flat, long drive to get till you got to my friend's like shed that I was sitting. And I used to look at the mountains as I would drive thinking, I should just keep driving into that mountains and disappear. Because I was just so depressed by that point. And I thought, oh yeah, let's do this antique thing. But I pictured it like this. See, I picture myself on set because I was going to still do my acting, right? I was just totally, this was just a side thing, this antique.
To live, yeah.
Yes, this furniture. I say antique, but we actually were bringing imported like furniture that was being made out of old wood. And
like bespoke furniture.
Yeah, like, you know, people, they were, at that point, they were taking old buildings and tearing them down. You know, when they would, building would get torn down, they would take the pine wood from the building, say an old like barn or something. And turn it into a table, and you know, that would be a whole repro line. So, you know, that stuff was selling well too. So anyway, let me go on that. So I'll start looking at your furniture and analyzing it.
Well, that furniture is massive in this part of London, isn't it? There's so many shops like
yeah,
that.
Exactly. So I picture myself like calling my sister from the set going, yeah, so what were the sales today, sis? You know, and just, right, you know, totally. You know, just being easy, you know, it being
her doing all the
thing.
Work.
Yeah, yeah. Maybe just be popping in and just helping out a bit. But of course, it's
manager,
you know,
by
running
proxy.
Anybody who's run their own business.
You got to be there hands on.
Unbelievable the amount of work. And I'm a bit of a control freak, I've learned. And it was the hardest thing I've done in many ways, but it was nonstop. So, and it did well. The shop was, you know, it was in Santa Monica and, you know, and we were selling. But this is the way we had to start building our own stuff there, and we had these incredible guys building. But I was in like nonstop working at it, and but earning some money, you know, starting for the first time.
I actually had a credit card.
You know what I mean? Like I never even had a credit card, and now they were sending them to me, begging me to have them, and I was like, wow, this is pretty good. I was, you know, I got married, and I was still auditioning, though. I still had this agent just about. He hadn't quite gone to become a photographer yet. And his mom was still working. You know, he's a nice guy. He was still sending me out every once in a while. And I would, and I got one film called Subterfuge, which is truly the worst film ever. So please no one watch that. I'm absolutely awful in it. But, you know, so I was still like trying to keep my feet in it, you know, and did a bit Bob's. But it was getting more and more possible. And, and making some money, though, you know, and then thinking, maybe I'm not meant to be an actor. You know, that was really coming, you know, into my mind. And I was enjoying, to some extent, doing this furniture stuff. It then basically happened that, you know, my mom's like, well, come over, you know, to the East Coast and help me run the here and your sister. You know, so I kind of thought, this is it, really. I think we're new. So my wife and I moved to the East Coast, and then I started running all the shops and more embroiled in it. And at that point, the only agent, my agent had then gone off to be the photographer. I had my English agent. She's an amazing woman. I've had the same agent since I was left drama school.
Still
and,
now.
Mm,
yeah.
Yeah, yeah. She was an assistant, really, at the agency that I went to, but she did all the work. And then she became an agent, another agent, and I went with her. And now she's at another agency, and I went with her. So I've always been with her. And she was still kind of my age. She was like, what are you doing this antique stuff for? You know, she doesn't talk like that. Sounds like a New Yorker. But she's from up north, so she's very blunt. You know, she's like northerner from Bradford. She like says it as it is. But you know, occasionally I'd be back in England. She'd put me up for an audition for something, you know. But I don't know. I would never be able to do it. But anyway, the point is I was doing, I had a big house. I had a son by then. My first child was born. I had a big house in the country in just outside New York. I had a big shop and another shop in LA, you know, and I'm driving back in my big car, you know, and my bank balance is finally, you know, paying the mortgage even at that point. And I was, I think I must have been in 33 or 4, I can't remember.
You're probably like my, I'm 33, so right, probably my exact age now.
Yeah, maybe you're older. Hadn't acted for, I'll tell you, it was like 99, so, and I'd done something, was it like 95, 96? I hadn't reacted for about 4 or 5 years.
At all?
Not really, you know, maybe, no, I think I'd, no, I don't think, I think the last thing it was like 95 or something, so it was like 4 years, nothing really. And, you know, some auditions and stuff, but. Really, and then I knew it was fading. I knew it was, but I, you know what, it was really hard. Like I didn't like watching movies because it would just make me depressed.
It's like a horrible reminder of the life you could have had.
You know, and then I was driving back thinking about my son who had just been born, and I was thinking, you know, I hope he has, you know, as you do, oh God, what kind of life's he gonna have? And I just had this thought popped in my head, God, I hope he doesn't have a life like me. I hope he doesn't have a life like mine, right? And I thought, what the fuck? I had a weird thought, and I just pulled over, and I just was like, I just started crying. I was like, this is not good. If this is the way I think, there's something's wrong. It was a real big moment. I remember on the side of the road, big old Ford thing that I was sitting in, just thinking, car, thinking, Jesus. And we tried a little bit. I tried to do, like, my ex was, you know, we're really good about it. We moved to Brooklyn to see, because we're living in like the place that just in the suburbs in Connecticut. It's just, you know, pretty beautiful. Some people love it, not me. I'm an urban guy. So we lived in Brooklyn for a year, and it was a lot of fun, but it was there that I just knew. And basically I had to make a decision for a number of reasons. My mother's like, you know, and they could tell, you know, deep, you know, that's what's great about moms. A good mom can just know if something's not right with her kid. And she just knew it wasn't really right. So she said, look, you got to make your mind up. Is this really what you want to do with your life? Because we need to do some paperwork to kind of bring it over to you. And you're talking like millions, right? Like being a millionaire, you know, multi-millionaire. And I just was like, I thought it through, talked it through a lot with my ex. And she was my wife then, obviously. But and we had this little baby. She had a housing association, one-bedroom flat that we'd held on to over here. And I had my agent that I hadn't, you know, done. I hadn't worked in like whatever, 7, 8 years, and just thought, I don't want to do this. You know, I don't want to be on my deathbed thinking that I could have, you know, had to go. So we just said, no, you know, I'm going to give it up, and just walked away from like millions and millions. And we had hardly any savings either, because we kind of been, it was expensive living in Brooklyn, you know. So we had a little bit, enough to kind of get us settled and be okay if we didn't make any money for a bit. And then we came back to London, and she got pregnant within about a week.
Oh man.
And so I had two babies, hadn't worked as an actor.
But you're happy, you're feeling brave.
But I was happy, I was really inspired, and I just, you know, just went for it. And I think one of the things that's great about having an experience like that, and that's why I think people really need to have a think about it, if they want to be in a, you know, whatever it is, if it's, you know, what you're doing, DJing.
Anything creative is hard work.
It's hard work, and you got to be sure it's really what you want. And they say to you, you know, you got, and you're young, you're like, yeah, it's definitely what I want. It's definitely what I want. And deep down, you got to answer that question, because what you're saying to people is not always what your head's saying. And that's kind of what I began to really realize when I got back to, you got to really see what, you know, what your real brain is saying to you. I think that's important as an artist all the time. Like, your subconscious, whatever, what is it actually saying to you? And And then if it, you know, for me, the experience of doing something else and being so unhappy made me realize it is what I want to do. So there's, you know, times when it's tough, especially in those first few years back, that I just know I'm much happier doing this, even though, you know, we don't have a car, you know, we're in one bedroom, you know, we're lucky to get a couple more bedrooms. We did a house flat swap or whatever you can do. So, that, you know, but, you know, I got two kids, but, you know, it was worth it. And it's stuck with me. It's really been a, you know, big thing. That was a huge, now, and that's the true reason why there's a gap between 19, what is it, 94 or something? And
I think 95 was definitely.
And then 2002. Yeah.
But then 2003, boom, Cold Mountain comes out.
Yeah.
And you're in that. Yeah. And it's one of the biggest, most lauded, successful films of its time. Cast is incredible. How do you get that role from nothing of note for so long?
I know, it was great.
Well, and it's like a meaty, decent role.
Partly because Auntie Miguel is just... special guy, unbelievable.
So did you audition? Did you read for it?
So I was doing, I was lucky. I came back and one of the first jobs I got was a play that was at the Almeida, but it wasn't really at the Almeida. It was because the Almeida was being renovated, I think. So it was at the like rehearsal rooms of the Almeida. but it was, you know, for the public kind of thing.
And, almost the Almeida.
Yeah. So I could put Almeida on my CV because they produced it. But we were in this kind of rehearsal room that was cool. And they set it up like a theater, and you know, and it ran for whatever a month, and then it toured, and it was directed by my brain is gonna
what was the play anyway, so we can set
the
scene.
You know, even the play at. I'm not, it was the play was like really weird, obscure play based on somebody's diaries. It was not very good. It was really long dialogue, like monologues and things. It was really dull. And I played a Dutch, his like Dutch servant. It was this guy that it was a true story. Like he never left his house, and he just I don't remember that guy's name later, but he's just amazing director, older, incredible. Directs a lot of opera. I don't know why I can't remember his last name, but and so this play was not great, to be honest with you. But we went on tour with it. Anyway, this director whose last name I cannot remember, who I can picture totally right now, who I actually know even from before because he brought down an amazing version of Long Day's Journey and Tonight with Kevin Spacey that came to my university when I was there. So I'd known his work and it was incredible. Like, he's an incredible director. So Anthony Minghella, because he saw that I was working with him at that time because I auditioned while we were on tour. I think that's what made Anthony Miguel go, oh, because I did a tape first. I think I went to see the cast. We were on tour in like Winchester or somewhere, or Oxford or somewhere, and I had to come into London and go on tape. And then in the tape, they're like, you know, they always say like, what are you up to at the moment? And I was like, oh, I'm doing this play directed by, you know, Jonathan Blah, whose name I can't remember right now, who's incredible. And I think that made Anthony Miguel go, oh, and that, and probably my face by then, it started to look a little bit more rugged and weird. So so I came down and met him like the next week. Again, I had to come from wherever I was. And weirdly, his offices were right near where I used to live. So I went and met him and just had a quick little read and just had a chat, really. Just such an amazing man. And then I had to wait like a week, just, you know, it's
longest
so,
week of your life.
Longest, because at that point, you know, obviously, as you just said, I had really not done anything, you know, so this was just huge. And then I got the call, you know, I thought I hadn't gotten it, and then I got the call at the end of the day. I was like, oh, and I was just, we were like jumping around with joy in the house. And the amazing thing with that too is, you know, I went out there, it was in the old days when they used to really treat you well on a film, you know, like flew you out, and then you got to take it through you didn't have to go through customs, you got to take it through a special place and all. It was like, you know, everybody, it was weird. Every single actor had their own driver and car. So it was Killian, myself, and another actor. There were the three baddies in that scene with Natalie Portman. And we all had a car. So we'd all follow each other until we finally said, look, we just all want to drive together, really, because we just want to hang out. So we don't really need three drivers, we just need one. But I remember I flew out there. I got there about a day or two earlier than Killian, and for some reason. And I remember going to set, you know, they to do a costume type thing or a makeup fitting or something. And there was Nicole Kidman, you know, and Jude Law was there, I think. And Renee Zellweger.
Zellweger, yeah.
And thinking, Jesus. And up comes Anthony Minghella, and just like, it's in the middle of shooting all this stuff with them, right? Nothing to do with me. I'm not filming for like a few more, no, almost like a week. And he comes up and just grabs my hand, you know, shakes my hand, grows, holds it with both hands. And I'm not kidding. And I told this story before he died. So, you know, you tell stories about someone who passed away, like he did young and still in the height of their creativity. You know, it tends to be a little bit, you know, people tend to exaggerate stuff and, oh, he's the most incredible human. This is a true story. I've always told this story even before he passed away. I've never felt anything like it. There was like this energy, because I was quite nervous, obviously, and this is a big thing for me. This energy, I just felt this complete release in myself. I just relaxed. And it was like flowing through him into me. It was the weirdest thing I've ever felt. And I'm not kidding. It was, and I'm not like too hippie-dippy. A little bit. I'm, you know, I'm a veggie. I'm a little bit. I'm a little yoga. But not this much. And it was like, wow. Incredible. And he also gave me this feeling like I was the most important person in that film. That moment, he was an incredible man. It was really incredible. I've never experienced anything like it. And then, yeah. So, and then we went on, and that was a lot of fun, because that was where I met Killian Murphy, who's just a lovely, lovely, lovely person. And we hit it off hugely that week. 2 weeks. I think we were out there almost 2 weeks. And just had we were in Romania.
Is that where it's
middle
filmed?
Of nowhere? Yeah, in the I think they wanted, because I'm from North. Like I said, I lived in North Carolina, and the book is set in North Carolina.
Yeah, yeah.
So I talked a bit about that when I met Anthony Minghella, and I think that obviously helped too. And they wanted to film in North Carolina, but A, I'm sure budget, and B, also there's too many. It was like, phone lines, and they just couldn't get around it. So they filmed in the mountains of Romania. It's quite far away from Bucharest. It was quite a drive. So we're really in this kind of skiing resort off season. It was so much fun. It was like, I mean, I was spoiled actually after that. I thought every film was like this. We were all living in this kind of ski chalet place. So everybody just had a communal room that we all hung out in, and anybody put music on they wanted to. And Killian's got great taste in music. He put music on, and there was Natalie Portman who'd be giving you a kiss goodnight. You know, I mean, it was like, you think, oh, this is how it normally is. Now I realize mostly you're in some big hotel, everybody's in their room, occasionally you'll go out to dinner, whatever. But it was this real like family vibe the whole time. And
I've spoke to a few actors, and they've always said that the actual experience of filming the projects is often as rewarding as the work itself, like everything around the work, you know, because it's often like a boot camp and a holiday. Obviously you're there to work, but it's these experiences and these friendships. And
yeah,
it seems like you've had that a few times in your life as well, like meeting someone early on and then later on you'll work with them. And obviously you and Killian got to do that scene in Peaky Blinders together.
Yeah, and also we met
and Batman Begins, Batman. Did you?
So it was great, because we're basically with
because that came straight after Cold Mountain as well.
At that point,
right?
I learned a lot from him. Like, you talk about learning, like he was a young actor when he was 26 or something, if that. You know, and he had filmed 28 Days Later.
Yeah.
Later, right? That's the one. They had filmed it, and it was coming out around the time that it was like a couple weeks after we were filming Cold Mountain. So, you know, it hadn't come out yet. And so he, you know, he wasn't.
He's not a star yet.
No, not at all. I mean, he was a young actor the casting directors knew, and you know that definitely he'd done, you know, done that the play Disco Pigs, and obviously, I'm sure he'd done some film work, but he was not anywhere near what happened to him. And it was amazing, because we're hanging out, and you know, the film hadn't come out, and then it came out, and see, it did well over here. You know, it did reasonably well, and then you're probably aware of this, but then. And then we hung out a lot, because he lived at that time, lived near where I lived. So we would go and we'd just go catch a movie together, or, you know, just do, you know, listen, go see some music or do whatever. Well, the thing I learned from him, though, going back, is we were flying back from Romania, and we were chatting and talking about, I think Colin Farrell, actually, about, because he was friendly with him, because he had done a film with him, actually.
They'd done an Irish film
together. Yes, a great film.
I can't remember the name of it, but.
Yeah. Really, he'd done some really good work already, Killian. That's right, I remember. And I think went on to do Girl with a Pearl Earring afterwards, but, which is weird, because he was on the phone to the director of that, who directed Hannibal Rising, which I was, so it's, you know, it's so weird how it all connects. But anyway, so we're flying back, and I'm chatting with Killian. He's talking about Colin Farrell, and he had just been, you know, made a certain amount of money on some film that he just done. I can't remember which one, right? And it was a lot of money, right? You know, not completely astronomical, but, you know, something that, and I remember Killian saying, I can't wait till I make something, or something like this. I mean, it was probably much more poetic than this, but, you know, I'm looking forward to the day that I'm going to make that amount, you know, which is going to be soon, kind of vibe. Like, I'm going to do it. And I went, yeah, me too. You know, me too. But I could see in his thinking that he really saw that, right? He really was like, yeah, that's going to happen to me. And I could see that I was saying it, but there was a little voice going, ah, it's not going to happen, you know? And I had, at that point in my life, I was actually studying with a guy who studied with Sam. I was still studying, I was still doing class. Every weekend, once a month, me and my mate, who was also an actor, would go, and we would go to these, you know, this course, which is very much still based on kind of, his name is John, I shouldn't name drop him because he'll be angry if he's listening to this. John Osborne Hughes, who studied with Sam and then did his own, he's basically kind of taken it in another direction a bit, but is more or less a similar type of method. And I was doing some work with him, and a lot of it's about looking at your own thinking, really. A lot of Sam's stuff is being really aware of your own thinking, both to know it as an actor, you know, to be able to do that in work, but also to see where your thinking is blocking you and messing you up, because it's a lot of what being an artist is about, our own thinking screwing us up. And I could see my thinking was like, not really, I was little voice was going, nah, fuck it. And it was huge, man, for me, huge moment. Where I was like, oh my God, because if you have that little voice, it ain't happening. That little voice is the one that wins. No matter how much you can say to your parents, yeah, I'm going to make it, mom and dad, or yeah, I'm definitely going to be a movie star or whatever. If that little voice is really the one that you're not, and most of the time we don't hear the little voice. Most of the time we're not aware of it, or unless it's really loud sometimes, but normally we just think, oh, it's not there. But you need to be aware of it is what the, you know, thinking, I believe. So I saw it and I kept watching it then. Like every time it popped in, I go, fuck you. You're just a little voice in my head. It's bullshit. It's just something that got put there as a little kid because some teacher probably, you know, and I kind of traced where whatever it was. But, and I looked at some of the other little voices that weren't doing the same. And that was a huge moment for me. Because Killian didn't have that little voice, you know.
He was self-assured. And
Or he had seen it, or that little voice, he had just dealt with it. Or some people, I think the voice is more destructive than others, or it's just not, they're not as aware of it or whatever. And the end of the story is that I started looking at that, and I, you know, just keeping an eye on it, right? Just really, and looking at just all the kind of destructive thinking rather than just being, and about a year later, 2 years, was it 2 years? When I got Doom, that amount of money, exactly that number.
Really?
Yeah. Weird, right?
Amazing.
Shows you that, I mean, our thinking is our the other thing I say to anybody as a young actress that asks me that is that you know, I say meditate because I think that's really important. And I say, you know, you got to really look at your thinking and look at those destructive thoughts that are, you know, the real ones, not the ones you're saying, oh yeah, I'm going to be a movie star, or I want to be an actor or whatever, but the ones that are truly coming in. So yeah, it was great. And I learned tons from him. But then he went on, and that summer, they released 28 days later, and it was so crazy. I remember, and it went huge. Right? I made like 60 million.
Yeah,
and he became
massive.
A movie star overnight. And I remember I hadn't seen it for like a month or two, and we hooked up. And I remember in Swiss Cottage, I remember seeing him. I go, hey man, how's it going? He goes, you won't believe it. It's crazy. Like, it's literally overnight, his life changed. I mean, it was madness, and he hasn't looked back. You know, it's been great, and it's great. Oh, every once in a while, we have a little exchange. She lives in Ireland now, so I don't see him like I used to. But on Batman, he was really helpful, because I helped him. I will say this: I helped him with his audition for that, because he auditioned for Batman originally.
Did he really?
Yeah, and he called me and goes, "I'm auditioning for this. I can't say anything, but for a new Batman film. I'm like, oh, but can you help me with the accent? I'm like, yeah. So we came over, we worked the scenes, and then he flew to LA, I think, and did the whole screen test thing, and they liked him, but gave him Scarecrow, I guess. And I remember him calling me, going, yeah, I'm not getting Batman, but it looks like I got this. And at that point, I started auditioning for, I had just began the process, long process of auditioning for Batman.
For so Joe
I
was like, Chill.
Well, I think I might, I'm hoping to be in it too.
Isn't that nuts? Yeah. Did Cold Mountain change everything then?
Not really. I mean, I think it only changed everything in that, like, I was the first time for me that I knew I could do it. It changed everything. The way it changed everything was the realization on that flight home. Yeah.
Right.
But in terms of people going, oh, Rich Brake from Cold Mountain, man, let's get him. Not really. I mean, my friend Eddie Marsden, I was saying that, in a way, it's, you always think it's going to be this one job that's going to make suddenly you're made, but you know that's really rare. Like it happened in Killian's, but even then, I'm sure there was, you know, if he talks about it, I bet you'll say there was lots of parts where
there's
he,
other
times
stuff
after that when
away.
It dropped or when it was like. But for like actors like myself, it's a build. You know, it's you just build a body of work that eventually they can't help but notice you because you just, you know, you're just this in their face all the time. And there's, you know, there's a building of a body of work, really. There isn't that great moment. So sort of that was the beginning of that build, but yeah.
And then another crazy series of events is the actor who plays Bruce Wayne's dad, Thomas Wayne, is Linus Roach, right? Who later on turns up in Mandy with you. He's Jeremiah, you're the chemist. Again, one of those. And what I didn't know about him is that his dad is Ken Barlow from Coronation Street.
No, I always forget that. And then, And then, because I hadn't seen Linus since we filmed in Batman. And then I didn't see him on Mandy because we're not in anything.
No scenes together.
And then I saw him at a screening they had over here. And it was great to see him again. I was like, wow, man. But again, I always forget that he was Ken Barlow's son. Yeah,
nuts, isn't it?
Yeah.
How was working with Christopher Nolan? I know it's a very small scene, but it's such a key scene to the psyche of Bruce Wayne. Obviously, the guilt that he lives with, you know, that feeds so much into that. And so it's a very key scene, despite the, you know, brevity of it.
Yeah.
Was it fun working with him?
It was, I mean, because I remember before we started, because Killian had been working on it already, and I was like, oh, how's it going? And he goes, well, if I can give you one piece of advice, where he, again, he talks far better than that, but he said that Christopher is not like the kind of guy that, you know, gives you lots of stuff, or if he likes what you've done, then he'll just move on. You know, in other words, move on to the next shot or the next setup or whatever. I was like, oh, that's really good to know. Because, you know, it's like, you're looking for a praise. Or,
So it
was actually, for me especially, because that was really nerve-wracking. Like with Anthony Miguel, I was nervous. Yeah, I was like nervous. I was spent the, you know, I remember calling Eddie going, we got a day off. Do you think I should just be like running my life? You know, we got pictures in this acting that we did. Like, should I run me? Or should I go see Vampire Castle with him? Or Dracula's Castle? Because he's like, look, just relax. Just run your, you know, do your pictures and then go. You know, it was ridiculous. I'm going, man. Should I stay in and do my work? Cause that's how nervous I was. But
as you said, you'd had that exchange with Anthony, that he'd set your mind at ease.
Yeah, so I felt better. And then that was good to know from Killian when I went in to do that. Because the first scene I did, because I have like, there's the courtroom scene, then there's the shooting his parents scene, and then there's the scene where I get shot, which is, you know, it was pretty easy. But the courtroom scene was the first scene that I had to shoot. And, you know, I have that little speech, and it's like, and I did a lot of preparation for it, a lot of work. I had a fair bit of time before we shot, and then just did a couple of takes, if not many. And then he just went, okay, great, move on. And I thought, right. And I have to say, when I see that, because I'm not a great one to watch, I don't watch my own stuff very much. I mean, I have to sometimes, obviously, but a couple of years ago, I just stopped trying to, you know, I just stopped.
So you're trying to avoid
the
premieres.
So if I don't have to watch it, I don't. Yeah, I do. I mean, the only one's Rob, so I'll go do Rob's stuff, because I just love him, we'll get to him. But the thing, but I've seen that scene, obviously, and then I was like, and I think that, for me, it's like, when I look at it, that is one of my favorite bits of acting that I've done, personally. If I had to pick a bit, I mean, I was just that, and it's a tiny little scene, but it's really, you know, something, you know, it's really, really, I really love that. And when somebody once commented and said, oh, I think that's it, you know, sent me a little post or something. And I thought, oh, it's nice that some people see it. It's because it was just things in that that I really love. And I, you know, subsequently could never see it again on it, you know. But
and that's when I guess all those years of training and...
I don't know what. It's just sometimes things just work out. And
yeah.
You know, sometimes like you do something and it's like, oh. And other times you can think you've done such great stuff and then you look at it and it's like, oh, it's crap. But that's, you know, just that's how it is. And I think one of the things about doing it for so long is you don't, you know, not to be so precious about it. And just, you know, I've done some work I thought was going to be brilliant. When I looked at it, it wasn't that great. And then I've done other things that I, like that scene, I didn't think, oh, that's great. I was just pleased that he said, move on, you know, and not done 50 takes and then moved on. So, yeah, I don't know. There's something, you just do the work and then do it and hopefully it looks good.
Well, everything changes in the edit, doesn't it?
It does. I mean, everything. That's why I actually don't, you know, in truth, it was about almost 10 years ago now. Yeah, maybe that long, that I made the decision to really stop watching my stuff. Unless, obviously, like, there's some things I do watch and sometimes you have to watch. But, or if it's a small enough part that, I mean, I'm more interested in seeing the film than walk on. But the reason is that I find that you don't have control. Like as an actor, one of the things I realized fairly early on is you can do all this great work, but the edit affects it. Sometimes the director, you know, I've been lucky. I've had great directors almost all the time. But the director, can they just shoot it? You think, oh my God, now I realize you're shooting it all in mid-shot or they don't have, it's just... So many things affect the performance that you have no control over, that in a way it's almost like the work that I do when I do the scene is the work I need to enjoy. And
yeah.
That's great. If I'm happy with that, whatever looks on screen, I can't control that ultimately. And it's been very freeing actually, making that decision not to watch my stuff generally.
And you've had some amazing directors straight after Batman and Doom. You go into work with Spielberg and Brian De Palma,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, I was really scared now, that night. Yeah.
For you, I imagine you would have grown up watching a lot of those great 70s films, like all the stuff that Rob loves, you know, Coppola, Scorsese, yeah. Spielberg, yeah. De Palma.
Yeah. Oh, De Palma was great. I was so pleased to get that.
Bobby DeWitt.
Yeah, that was great. I had to meet him for the audition, and it was... actually, Eddie Morrison was at the audition too. We were both prepared together for it because we used to, back in those days, a lot we'd prepare with each other. So if he had an audition, I'd go to his house and help him prepare, and if I had one, he'd help me prepare. So we both had one. He had a different part, and so we were both, you know, preparing. his is the coroner, I think. He went in for the coroner, and he went in, and he comes out, and he's like, and he goes, right before I went in, the casting director said to me, make it funny. Bob, like, you know, De Palma likes him if it's, you know, it's, and he's like, how do you make a coroner funny? I'm like, Jesus. So I went in, did Bobby DeWitt, and it was great. I mean, Brian De Palma's got like this whole, you know, there's a sort of myth that he's just this nasty, tough guy, and he's really hard on his cast and stuff. But I really liked him, got on with him really, really well. I mean, I was only out there for, I think it was two trips. It was Bulgaria we shot that. A couple of times, but I really dug him a lot, and I loved his films. I mean, I'm a big Scarface fan.
I think one of the most overlooked and underrated gangster films ever made is Carlito's Way.
Yeah,
I think that film is as good as the Godfather films, as good as Scarface, good as Goodfellas, but it never gets mentioned in that same breath. But I think both Pacino and Sean Penn in that film, and just the style of it, the camera work, the set design, it's an incredible film.
Yeah. No, he's a really great director. He really is. Yeah, it was nice. So at the end of that little, you know, the scene, I have that scene with where I'm, you know, I'm getting beaten up and stuff and thrown down or whatever. And
with Josh Hartnett, yeah?
Yeah. And we shot that thing, and we actually had to, I think we had to a couple of days shoot, believe it or not, to do that. And then at the end, I get this big hug from Brian De Palma. I was just like, wow. You know, it's nice getting a big hug from this incredible, like, iconic director.
Yeah.
I'll never forget that moment. I loved working with him. And then that same summer, I worked with Spielberg. So I was like, oh, my God, this summer I bookended. I think I did Spielberg at the end of the summer and De Palma at the beginning of the summer. That was it. And that was for Munich. It was a tiny, you know, little scene, but I don't think I've ever been so nervous, because that was, we had to, it was me, it was three of us out, these kind of, I guess we're these CIA agents, and typical Spielberg, I mean, Spielberg's incredible to watch. I mean, like, the way his mind works is on a, it's on an, in terms of filmmaking, it's in another planet. It's like, it's, because it was, in that scene, I think the camera, it does all this stuff, right? It follows these different people. It's like almost one shot, or there's definitely some very complex thing going on where the camera's across the street, then it comes on the other side. I mean, it was huge, right? Like a huge thing. And he was editing in his mind. You could see that he had it all in his brain. Like the way it works.
Just meticulous. Right away,
it was unbelievable. Like his mind, and he's also so relaxed. In between takes, he's just putting on some on his iPod, some weird comedy thing, or whatever he's there listening to. Or he's just an incredibly relaxed guy, but at the same time, his mind is just like somewhere else, like completely working the whole film out. You know, this whole scene out, and it was really extraordinary. But the way it worked was that it ended up kind of landing on me. I think at the end of this whole big sequence of camera movements, it lands on me, and I have to say something. I have to be drunk and say something. So we do the whole thing, and it kind of lands on me, and I do my thing. And Spielberg comes over, and he's like, yeah, maybe not so drunk, you know, maybe the character not so drunk. And I'm like immediately like, oh, you know, I have one thing to do, right? Literally, I mean, I'm there just doing this one, like three lines or something. And I'm just like, oh my God, I just thought, oh, and I sort of blew his shot, I guess, because, I mean, in essence, I think, because he wanted to kill. I was like, oh, I'm just terrible. And then he goes, okay, take two. And, you know, it was a long little setup as well, so it takes a few minutes to set it up. So, and honestly, at that point, I felt like a postman who'd won a thing to be in a Spielberg film or something, because I just forgot. I mean, literally, I just wanted the floor to open up and me to drop through it, because just, oh my God, I can't mess this up again. It would just be terrible. So comes, you know, the whole thing goes, ooh, doo, doo, and it just lands on me, and boom, it was fine. It was good. He was happy. He's like, yeah, it's great, you know. So, whew. But I had to, I think literally right before he said, you know, action, I was just like, went, please, God, just help me get this right. I think I've used that plea to the universe a few times since, when there's been those times. Because I think every actor goes through, I know every actor that works, you know, a reasonable amount goes through the experience. I've been with people where I've been on the other side, watched people going through it. And it's just where you just can't get it right, you know, and it just, the pressure is just building because they have to do another take, and whether it's a line or whether it's just getting what the director wants, you know, it's one thing if you're Jude Law and you're, you know, best friends with the director. It's another thing if you just come in for a day or two and they just want you to like, cause it's, I mean, I tell you one of the big things I learned on Cold Mountain was that it's so much harder to be the kind of actor that comes in and character actor that does a bit, because you're expected to come in and do it.
Yeah.
I mean, Jude Law, I was saying, even though he's got to carry the film and he's got his own set of pressures, which are astronomical, in a way, he has.
They're in a groove.
It's easy. Yeah, he's got a relationship with Mangala. They've done films before. They've, you know. So in a way, I was like, ah, man, he has it easy. But then, of course, he's got his own set of things to deal with in terms of being a leading man on a big film. But,
yeah. And then again, you took up with him on Spy. It just keeps happening, doesn't it? It's crazy. I do think it's just a common thing.
Because our kids know each other, because I have teenage boys, and he has a bunch of kids. And one of his daughters is friends with one of mine. So I we used to live fairly near each other, so I'd run into him occasionally. And oh, yeah, man, yeah. And then we did Spy, and by then our kids were quite good friends. So, you know, hey, okay, you know, so we hung out. It was a lot of fun. Spy was great fun. That was fun. It was just fun, period. And it was quite crazy. Yeah, because, you know, I think it was Budapest. So running around Budapest on a Saturday night with Jude Law is, you know, there's literally like a crowd following, you know.
And sort of mingle? Because there's a few actors I've heard that just don't.
Yeah, it's hard. I mean, he tries to. I mean, we had to like escape through a window, I think, of a club to get, or like through our back, you know, some kind of, yeah, it was like a window or something. I forget. We had to kind of, just because it was, you know, it was getting too crowded with people. But I think, you know, as much as he can, it's hard for him. I mean, that's the kind of thing. I mean, you know, I complained about the pressures of having to come in and nail a scene, but nothing like the pressure he gets because he's just, you know, constantly getting hounded by people or people filming him when he's just trying to, you know, go out and have a drink with his mates. I mean, I can't imagine. And then it's on YouTube and, you know, and it's like, oh, it's just crazy.
Well, the camera phones have really changed the world for the worse in many ways for that. I was watching a Morrissey show once and it was me, my ex-girlfriend, and then Russell Brand. And we were just on this row enjoying the show. And then as the night unfolded, more and more people would notice Russell Brand was in the row and would linger on the edge of the row, just like filming him, watching the gig. And we were in front of him, so in the sort of the eye line of, and we were kind of just looking at them like, how rude do you have to be? Like, it's one thing going up to someone, right, going, hey, Rich, I recognize you from your work. I'm a big fan. Can I have a picture?
Yeah.
That's one thing. But to just be like, hey, there's the dude that plays the Night King. Let's film him in Tesco. Like,
I know. Weird, right? It's just, yeah. I mean, it's just weird. Weird that people would do that.
Do you ever get asked about the Muse video that you did?
Like on the street, like randomly, oh, I loved you in that Muse video. Not
in
often.
Interviews.
Sometimes when I'm at Comic Cons, like I was actually weirdly, I was in Spain a couple of weeks ago doing a Comic Con, and somebody brought a copy of that for me to sign.
Amazing.
Of the Muse.
Well, that was right at the tail end of the music industry, I think, when the budgets were really there for music videos on such a huge scale. That kind of era is pretty much gone now. Like the music industry has changed so much, probably even more so than the film, I think. And that video is like epic, like the scale of it. It's like a mixture of a spaghetti western, kitsch sci-fi, 70s kung fu film. Like it's all these stylistic elements thrown in and you're the kind of like the villain.
Yeah.
Like cowboy in black.
The sheriff or something. Yeah. It was.
Are you a Muse fan?
Joseph
How did that
Kahn.
Come about?
No, I mean, I you know,
how
I
does
I knew
a music
their
video
music
casting was, process differ?
Yeah, it was weird. It was, you know, Joseph Kahn directed it. Who's a really big video director. Like
right.
Probably, I would say, undoubtedly the biggest video director in the world. I mean, he does films, too. I was in one of his films, a small thing. But his films are, he did something like one of the Torque-type films that didn't do well. But he does his weird, like, these crazy kind of films that are very unique. So he directed it, and he's, you know, he is a really talented guy. He does like loads of, like Tiff, he does all the Taylor Swift stuff. I mean, he does everybody's big, he does the videos. So they come up with the ideas too, and this crazy idea. And I just got at that point I was mostly looking after my kids. I was doing a lot of like, both of my boys were quite young at that point. I remember I was lucky, spending a lot of time with them. I don't think I'd worked much that year. I can't remember.
That because you'd already filmed the likes of Batman Begins, Doom,
because I had
that.
I got Doom, Batman Begins,
Black
Hannibal
Dahlia.
Rising. I mean, it was just like boom, 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 boom. And I was like, yeah, I'm rolling. You know, and this is what they're saying. Like, you think, it's all happening now. I mean, you know, Doom is like, because that didn't do as well as we'd all hoped. Obviously, that was a factor. But it was like, yeah, it's all happening. And then I think there was like, I don't know. I can't remember what I did that year. I mean, this is 2006 or 2007, something like that.
2006, yeah.
Six, right? So I don't think there was much going on. Like if I had done anything, I must have done something. But so they can't, you know, I got a call, come do a casting for a music video. Oh, I know why. Because my agent likes Muse.
There you go.
So that's why. Because she goes, oh, I know you don't want to do like music videos. Probably,
but I want to meet them.
I'm a big fan of Muse. So, you know, and that was what it was. And then I went and I did, I don't know what the hell I had to do. And then Joseph knew Batman Begins though. And he's like, oh my God, that's a guy from Batman Begins. Definitely, you know, get him in. And I did that. But the guy who plays the cowboy in that,
yeah,
the good guy, well, we got, again, this is what you were talking about earlier about how it's the experience as much as it is the actual thing. We just got on really, really well. And he's now like one of my closest friends.
Amazing.
Yeah, I'm still been in touch for him, you know, all the time. He's like a very, very, very close friend. So you just never know. Yeah, it's crazy.
I want to get into Rob Zombie and Game of Thrones and a couple of the other more indie films that you've done.
Time, right?
But can we change batteries? Because I'm worried that these are going to perhaps run out.
Yeah.
Is that cool? So we're going to do a part one pause.
Yeah.
And we're back in the room. Round two.
Talking so much about the changed battery.
That's good, though. Yeah. I'm going to do this as a two-parter. So, Rob Zombie, I heard an interview with you, and you said, and obviously you've worked with some amazing people that we've mentioned, you know, Anthony Minghella, Brian De Palma, Steven Spielberg, Christopher Nolan. And you said in this interview that Rob Zombie is your favorite director to work with.
Yeah, 100%. Yeah. I mean, I work with great directors, and in no way am I saying that I don't like the other ones. But if I had to choose one, without a doubt, Rob's my favorite, without a doubt. Yeah.
How did you get the call for Halloween 2? I read that it was Sid Haig who put you forward. Yeah. Is that true? Or is
No, that's no. From never believe everything on the internet. It's crazy what people do. No, it's what happened really was that I auditioned. I was going through separation at that point, and business. It was 2008 here. And just like there was nothing going on. Like all these projects, I had 3 projects get canceled that I was going to do. And they were good ones as well. Or 2 were canceled, 1 changed directors. And so he recast the whole thing. And it was just like, oh, I was like, oh my God. And of course, when you, I don't know, have you ever been separated, man, or divorced? It's like,
I've been separated.
Big change. And you got to look at different financially, everything. I had a couple of kids. So I had thought I got to go spend some time in LA. You know, I hadn't been to LA and done the LA thing for a long time. So I moved I was flying back and forth all the time because I had these kids, but I moved to LA in 2000, right at the beginning of 2009. And my first audition, I think, was for Halloween 2. So right. It was like, can you come? I was like, all right. I went in, did the scene. And I think you can actually see the audition. It's somewhere, it was on like one of the DVDs. I think they had it as one of the extras, DVD extras.
Were you cool with that?
Yeah. I think, I don't even know if they asked me permission, but I don't know if they did, but I don't mind because it was a good audition. Actually, it was fun. It was he's a crazy character, like the necrophilic.
I was going to say the characters that you played up until then, you'd done kind of like sleazy businessmen, morally reprehensible kind of, you know, dastardly characters, but I think this was probably the first all-out deranged warped character in your canon, right? Just all-out fucking like, a fucked up guy. And he's talking about, you know,
shagging corpses,
raping corpses. Incredible.
It's brilliant. I mean, Rob's a great writer. I mean, a lot of people, they just don't give him credit for it, but he's honestly a great writer. And as the opening of 31, but he just wrote this crazy scene with these 2 more guys. You know, I mean, most films that would be just 2 people driving a truck with the corpse of, you know, Michael Myers as last victim, and then Michael Myers in the back, whatever, and they would have some banal conversation, but not Rob. It's just weird discussion about shagging one of the corpses. And I just did and Rob doesn't like to be at auditions. He just has the casting director tape them, and then he looks at them. And so I just went in the casting director and just did this weird thing with the corpse, the necrophilic guy, and then next thing I know, I got this call from my agent in LA. It was from my LA agent, and saying they want to offer it to you. And I was like, great. And then I was like, oh my God, Rob Zombie. And I knew his music, but that was it. I hadn't really seen his films or anything. So I watched the films, and I was like, oh my God, you know, like Devil's Rejects or whatever. And then check this, you know, videos out, and he's just this, you know, how intense he is, and he's gonna make him, he's like, his crowd's going mental, and I just figured he's just gonna be this insane rock star, crazy director. It was just gonna be a nightmare experience. I was like, oh. So I was kind of nervous, and you know, I flew to Atlanta to shoot it, and I meet him, and he's, you know, just the sweetest, gentlest, just incredibly generous man. I'm standing outside the my trailer chatting to him, and he's a vegetarian, a vegan, and I was a vegetarian. I've been trying for years to give up cheese, and we're having a chat about vegan cheese, and I'm thinking, wait a sec, I'm with this guy that I'm talking about vegan cheese, you know, and this, I mean, he's, you know, in many ways nothing like the persona that, you know, you the rock and roll persona, although he is probably the coolest guy I know, but still.
He's a very, as you say, sweet, considered, extremely intelligent individual. Oh,
incredibly intelligent.
Massive film geek, like a student of cinema. And I mean, the work that he's done has, I think, had varying degrees of success in terms of the critics' response. But if you're a fan of that style of filmmaking, like, he's the master. He's up there for me with Rodriguez and Tarantino.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
And you can see the influence of those guys on him, particularly, I think, with the writing and the dialogue. You can see, like, he's very much a kind of Tarantino guy in that sense, isn't he? Like,
oh, yeah, yeah. He's so sharp. And it's, you know, and he's, I mean, the thing I mean, it's so many qualities that are incredible and incredibly inspiring. Like, one thing I often say when people ask is, you know, the thing I think that makes him one of my favorite directors, or my favorite director, and one of the things is that he inspires everyone, like everyone, to be as creative and the best they can be on a set. It's like, not just the actors, but even the producers, you know, and even the runner who might be just doing their intern for the, you know, everybody's just so geared up to be in this kind of gang to do this work. It's intoxicating. I mean, it's really incredible, and that's partly because he's such a creative, like, he's like a force of creativity, and that's what you see when we were just talking earlier about how he's doing touring at the moment.
Yeah,
he's doing this. He's shooting instead of, like, he toured last year with Manson, and, you know, they had a lot of photos he was posting on Instagram. But this year we've got videos. He's doing videos. He has Rob Fenn going with him and videoing as well, which is like genius move. It's like, you know, we'll video, do videos, and give, you know, people are getting videos now on Instagram of seeing it and getting geared up. And I wouldn't be surprised if there'll be some, you know, video that comes out, DVD or something. I mean, he's just constantly thinking. He's so creative. He draws. He just doing something all the time. It's incredibly inspiring.
He raises his capital himself as well, right?
Yeah, I mean, he has, obviously, Lionsgate and Saban are involved in Three from Hell, and they were involved, or I think Saban bought 31, but, you know, he to some extent, I know that there was the whole crowdfunding for 31, which helped. I mean, it definitely didn't cover the full budget, that's for sure, but it helped pay for some lunches or whatever.
Yeah,
it did. I mean, it's tough to make a movie with Three from Hell. They had, you know, obviously, because it's a Devil's Reject sequel, there was much more proper funding, and, you know, he didn't have to do any crowdfunding for that, and they definitely gave him some money for that one. But it's good.
Tell me about your initial reaction when you got delivered the script for 31 and you're reading that opening monologue from Doomhead, because that is one of the finest pieces of dialogue to any opening scene that I've ever seen.
It's unbelievable.
Did you change even a word?
No. I mean, honestly, because a lot of people come up to me and, you know, they'll say, that opening monologue, man, you were so, you know, and I really appreciate it. Yeah, I mean, I have some really, really lovely reactions from people. But I always say, you know, I learned the lines and said it, because Rob had written. And, you know, one of the things, great performance, you know, you realize when you've been doing this for a while, is that it's not just the actor that makes these performances happen. I mean, it's the writer, it's the director. You know, Rob made the choice to shoot black and white. Rob made the choice to put the camera right on me, and then wrote that incredible monologue, which I did not change a word at all. I mean, I basically drove around LA repeating it so much that it was embedded in my skull by the time we shot the scene.
Because it's a one take shot as well, isn't
basically
it? Pretty much.
He said, like, what I want
to
do
is about two-thirds
exactly,
of the way through. But
exactly. He's like, I just want to shoot. I really want to just shoot this as one take, Rich, you know, so can, you know, that's my aim. And then, you know, cut away. So I knew, I was like, kind of, it was my challenge. I thought, when he finally cuts, I hope it's as late as possible. So the later he cuts, and I know, the more successful that I've been. So if he obviously cuts to Daniel Roebuck in the chair really early, then he's obviously not that, you know, there's something, he's not really happy what he's seen. So I was kind of like, how long is it going to go before how long is it going to go before he cuts to Daniel? When I was pleased, it goes a long time. So he wanted that. He wanted it to be, he'd had that whole opening image, I think, a long time in his mind, that he really wanted that to be this one long take of this kind of nutcase giving a crazy speech to a man about to die.
It's a dream role. I mean,
yeah,
I'm just going to whack this back on as well. With the sex scene, when he gets the call that he's got to be brought into the game, and he's Ginger having man. Sex with this woman, and there's like Nosferatu's playing on the TV, and there's like this metal music playing.
Yeah. I mean, it was when I read the script, and I was like, oh my, you know, my first reaction was just like, I was over the moon. I mean, as any actor would be with a part like that. And then within about 2 hours, I was like, oh my God, am I going to be able to do this? You know, it's just, I don't want to let him down. And I think in a way that became my thing. Because I was lucky, I was living in LA at the time, and I had a couple of weeks off before we filmed. So I flew back to London to spend some time with my kids and also just really get that part into my head. So I spent all that time on it and then flew back to LA to start. So that helped. And also, I had a kind of thing, is I just didn't want to let Rob down. I mean, it was a big, big thing for him to offer me that. And I subsequently learned, I'm glad I didn't know this at the time, again, Rob being really smart not to let anyone listen to me know this, was that he had to really fight for me to get that part.
Really?
Because, oh yeah, I mean, the money people wanted, like, you know, a bigger name for sure. You know, whether it be a horror name or whatever, but they definitely didn't, who the hell's, you know, Rich Brake, and what, you know. And he really fought hard. And said, no, man, he's the guy to do it.
Did he know that off just the back of that one coroner scene? Did he just see you being this guy?
Yes. I mean, I guess, because, I mean, you know, he's not, I doubt it, you know, I'm trying to think of some silly film I might have been in that I doubt he really watched. I mean, it's probably, I mean, I think it's, he just, he's, again, like, I don't know how he can do that, because he's constantly finding actors, you know, or someone who was great once, and then, you know, he refines them. And
well, Sid Haig,
yeah,
classic
Sid, I mean,
case.
Totally. I mean, you know, the apocryphal story is Sid was managing a, you know, apartment buildings or whatever, and, you know, and then Rob brought him in, and, you know, he's, you know, obviously huge. So I don't know. I mean, I'm like, what if there's something that he just knew I could do it? And, so he fought really hard, which, again, I'm glad I didn't know that until later, but because I've been really nervous then. But I didn't want to let him down, you know. So that was, every day I would just be, you know, I would just have a little meditation, a little prayer. I was just like, I'm just going to do my best, and I don't want to let Rob down. And yeah, so I'm really proud of that film.
It's amazing.
You know, I mean, it gets some of the fans aren't as keen of it, but then others love it. So it has a real love hate thing. But
what about that line when you go, "Let's do it Whitechapel style"? Is that you?
What, the line? No,
he
wrote that.
He wrote that as
well.
Yeah,
and I thought
that's some deep knowledge.
I cannot do a London accent, so I had to do a kind of, you know, sort of a little bit of a Cockney in my attempt. But
kudos to Rob then. He had that reference in his head.
Yeah, he just put that in. You know, I did, because Rob's really allows you really to do a lot of improvisation. He's very happy to do that. In fact, he encouraged it. In Three from Hell, I do quite a bit more. And it was totally encouraged by him, some crazy stuff. And I'm not sure I should be in the film, but it was a laugh. But in this one, although I'm sure he'd been happy for me to improvise, I hardly at all had to,
because the dialogue was so good.
I mean, I can't think when, you know, if there was anything that, man, I might have one or two lines, but not really. Like, all those speeches were just word perfect.
Wow,
you know, it was crazy. And when I'm having sex, that's actually a very famous porn star from the 80s named Ginger Lynn. So, and I'm of that age. So I'm like,
in the
80s, I would have been a teenager. so, and the night before, because I was nervous, that was like, to be honest with you, that's my first, I used to say love scene, and then Jeff Daniel Phillips corrected me once at a panel, said, that's his idea of a love scene. But that's not the first love scene I've ever done in anything. So I'm reading this, I'm like, and that was the one thing that made me nervous. Most nervous of all, it's like, I was really anxious. And that was about day four of my shooting, or day five. If it may even sooner. And so I was like, oh, and I didn't know who it was going to be that I was with. I was like, oh. So night before, the producer says to me, oh, but you know, it's a great producer, by the way, Mike Elliott, who does all of Rob's films. He's an incredible guy too, because most producers, you know, I don't know, hit and miss, but he is incredible. And Mike's like, oh, it's Ginger Lynn. You got Ginger Lynn's your date tomorrow. I was like, oh my God. So then I went from being a little terrified to absolutely beyond catatonically terrified. So he showed up, and and Ginger's in the trailer getting her makeup done or whatever, and I kind of went in and introduced myself. She goes, and she says, and oh, by the way, in my trailer, they hang, you know, because it's like, they give you these underwear that are like skin colored or whatever, so that you can be, you know, not naked, but naked kind of thing. So they're all hanging in my trailer. So I come in, I see Ginger. Hi, Ginger. She goes, yeah, hi. I'm introduce her. And she's really nervous because they had just changed the whole script on her and she hadn't realized it. The lines had changed. They'd given her like the script a bit late. So she was quite nervous and she acts. She's a great actor, actually. Really, really great. But, you know, she hadn't done it for a little bit. So she was quite nervous. And I was really nervous about the sex bit, which she's much more experienced than me on. Right?
So no doubt.
This might work. And then she goes, so what are you going to wear? She's asked me, you know, when we do this. And I said, well, I know, what were you thinking? She goes, well, I used to be a porn star, so I'm happy to just go naked. I said, Ginger, if you go naked, I'm going to go naked. So we just went completely stark naked for it. And it was honestly the most, this is what working on that film was amazing. Like every day I go in, there'd be a scene, I think, oh, if we can just make the scene as good as it's written and I feel good afterwards, that would be great. And every time after we finished, I would feel that scene is 100 times better than I thought it would go. Partly because Rob would just come up with stuff or we would come. And that was a great example of that. Like I was just, if I could just get through the sex scene and it looks okay. But we just ad-libbed death on that one. We did ad-lib. Like he goes, just make it filthy.
Yeah.
So there's stuff on the cutting room floor that would literally make my poor mother pass out. And it's like crazy stuff. But she was brilliant. She was nervous. So I was like trying to just keep her calm and, you know, help her with the acting. We ran lines a lot. And then, of course, she just helped me stay calm. And we just, honestly, it was absolute blast. But, yeah. And then it was my girlfriend's birthday. So I'm texting her, actually, faking this thing. She's back in London. I'm going, well, with Ginger Lynn actually doing a sex scene. What?
Happy
my girlfriend
birthday.
Is very, very understanding. She's very cool.
How was it strangling Rob's wife? Was that a kind of tough scene for you to approach?
No. And she's another great actor, way underrated. Gets, you know, again, because she could do a lot more acting. I asked her the other day, I said, you know, you could do a lot more, but she doesn't really want to. I mean, she's very, very happy with them.
They got a good thing going,
they
right?
do. Yeah. And they like, and being, so they like movies, being together. So. And I think if she was working more, doing more acting, she'd have to be a part a lot more, obviously. And they love being together. And they're a great couple. And the other thing I say, the reason why I think Doomhead works so well is because of her.
Well, that final scene with the pair of them in the road.
Exactly. You know, that's my favorite scene.
Dream on playing.
My favorite scene.
Just covered in blood.
That and all the stuff too, where she's down and she's so terrified, and I'm doing the whole speech about Che Guevara and the Whitechapel stuff and all that. And she's like, you know, she was brilliant that day. Like, I mean, she's always brilliant, but that day, you know, it was like, because it was an intense scene for her. You know, she gets hit, she has to be like, and just completely at the end. And then, of course, we shot pretty much the next day or that day, the final bit too, you know, on the road. And she's so good. That's why I could do what I could do, because she's so just willing to go there and do that. Because if she was all precious, or you know, she's not at all. I mean, she's completely like, I mean, what she had to go through on that film was brutal. Like, she was just absolutely beaten by the end of it. And she worked most days, and every day was just like covered in blood. And I mean, it was intense, and that was a really intense day. And you know, she was brilliant. They were really brilliant. And that's why, again, Doomhead wouldn't be Doomhead if it wasn't her being so brilliant on the other side of that.
Another one of the bits that I love is when you're in the bathroom and you're like hitting yourself to get your nose all bloody, and you're going, you're not crazy, you're in control, you're not crazy, you're in control. Was that in the script as well?
No, I don't think it was. I'm trying to remember, but I think Rob came up with that. Again, that's what's so fun about it. You go in, the scene is this, it's going to be, you know, on paper. But then Rob's like, well, I'm having the idea that maybe you punch yourself. Or he might say like he punched himself or something. But it was very, you know, wasn't a big thing in the script. And Rob's like, well, I'll do it. Why don't we do it? Like, and he's kind of working it out. I'm sure he has a lot of it already in his mind. But when he's there, he's like, oh, you know, I'm shoot you from behind. You know, so the camera's behind me and he's like doing that whole thing. And, you know, I feel weird because you're not really hitting yourself. But you know, and then when you see it, it's like, wow, you know. And then the whole like, when I'm screaming, I'm not crazy, I'm in control. And I mean, that's a little bit me adding to more fucks and shit, because I love adding fucks. I think at the end of Halloween 2, I say fuck like 20 times as I'm dying.
Yeah, when you're just about to be decapitated. Fuck. I want to ask you this, Rich. You seem to have a very uncanny ability to tap in to real darkness, real craziness. You're obviously not that. You seem like a lovely man. How come you find that so easy? Do you think that there's any reason why you suit that kind of a character so well and why you can go to those places so easily?
I think what it is, partly, again, it goes back sort of the training we're talking about earlier, and the need to really look at your own thinking. So obviously I've been cast partly just a lot of it because of the way I look to these darker roles. So in a way they were coming my way early on. And then kind of at some point, I don't even know when it was, but I realized I do remember really understanding on Game of Thrones, for example, where I'm just darkness, like just evil, but have no lines. It really hit me on that one. But the need to go to that, within me, to go to that dark place, like that's my responsibility. I'm sounding a little wanky here, but in kind of as an actor, if I'm going to play those roles, I can't pretend to go there. I can't, because most of us, all of us can do it. Like all of us can think and be in a place where we're all capable of thinking everything. So we can go to those dark places, like, and we probably do occasionally. And usually when we think, oh, I'd like to just fucking blah, 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 whatever it might be, our brain either goes, oh, I can't think like that. You know, that's how we, because we're programmed not to think those things, or, you know, and they can be bad. I mean, like really bad stuff. And I can't let my little thing do that. I have to go there, right? That's my responsibility. And so at some point, I just allowed that to happen, and to know that it's just, ultimately it's not going to kill me. Get rid of that little voice so that I can, for fear of sounding really wanky, inhabit this really, really dark place without any fear, just really be there 100%.
And come back okay.
Yeah, because ultimately you have to trust that you'll come back okay.
Yeah.
And you will. I mean, it's the fear that we won't come back okay. And also mostly it's programming, social programming, that we're not meant to think these thoughts.
Yeah, you know? Yeah.
That just allowed that to happen, and somehow, and then I was able to access it. And on Game of Thrones, when I was doing that Hard Home episode, I remember the first night walking down and raising my arms and doing it, and I was just like covered in prosthetics and just like, and then my eyes are fucking killing me because of the biggest damn contacts between human eye, and I'm like, what the fuck is the point of this? And then I go in home that night, I go, I got to figure out why I'm doing this, really. What's it about? And then I really realized who that character was in the relation of this immense universe that's really impacted people in a huge way throughout the world.
And biggest TV show of all time.
And there's a reason, I think, because it so taps into like all the things that Greek theater taps in, like why we need film and theater, really, as a catharsis about good and evil. About everything, even has incest, the like,
betrayal,
everything.
That's yeah, all those Shakespearean traits.
Totally, totally. And this character really betrays. At that time, I felt betrayed. Utter darkness, utter evil. Our greatest fear is not just death, but after death, someone fucks with us and turns us into their army or whatever. In his case, but you know that we're not even, you know, we're at being controlled even beyond death, you know, by this man. So I just thought, no, I really have to inhabit that. So the next day we go back, and I really then did. I really made a real effort to do what I was saying earlier with this particular character. I did the same thing, just walked. You know, basically walked around, I made a pier, raised my arms, right? But in a much different place, I felt. And immediately, whereas the day before I'd just done it, like, yeah, that's great, great, thanks. They go, oh, it was brilliant. Nothing changed. Like, no different action, right? But the director was like, everybody, even the cameraman was like, oh, it was so brilliant. But it was weird, and that was all because of something going on up in my head was different, you know. It's just, so it really shows me that whatever, it's does stuff does work, you know, as an actor anyway. But yeah, weird.
The guys from Mastodon were in that scene. Did you get to meet them? Did they come up and say hello? So they're like a metal band, and they were definitely in that.
Oh, that's right.
They were definitely in
that. You know,
that
hardly anybody
scene.
Came and said hello, because I was just covered in glue and shit, and I hadn't slept but 3 hours, so I was mostly just sitting on my own, sipping out of a straw.
Was that experience enjoyable for you, and why did you leave? Why did you not stay until the end?
It was enjoyable, and it was enjoyable in that I was a part of an amazing thing, and I knew it even then. It was enjoyable, and then that the people on it are incredibly talented on every level, you know, whether it's the, what, you know, at every cast, crew, everybody, and the amount of
props,
money spent on it, everything. Yeah, everything. So costume. Brilliant. Like, I mean, I flew back and forth to Ireland to do just costume and makeup like four times before we even started. I mean, there's so much attention being put into it. So that was incredible. The actual filming of it was hard because it's, you know, I sleep 3 hours and I was like 6 hour makeup in the morning, 2 hours.
6 hours, that's how long it was.
Two to take it off. So 8 hours just makeup alone. And the contact lenses were brutal because they're this kind of sclera, whatever they call them, but they kill you. And after 4 hours, they have to take them out. So you can imagine your body's like trying to reject them, putting them back in. They're like literally holding me down. So that was tough. But, and also, man, you had like fingernails that were up to here. So I couldn't do anything. I couldn't even pee, or I definitely couldn't take a shit because, I mean, they would have to shut the whole production down, you know? So it was like, I had to be careful how much I ate. I mean, the whole thing, it was like a real interesting kind of physical experience. But in terms of being a part of that, I'm so grateful because it was, like I said, it was a real honor. It's a real honor to be a part of that and to play that character. Why I didn't come, I mean, basically I was doing, they weren't like letting us know if they were going to use me. All I knew was he might be important. He might, you know, I didn't know a lot. And I was also doing Bastard Executioner, which was a good part at the time and what I thought might be a big show because it was Sutter's, he's done
Kurt Studi, Sons of Anarchy.
Sutter's Anarchy. All right, he'd just done Sons of Anarchy, so this was his next thing.
Well, cop from that is the other coroner in Halloween 2.
He's a nice guy. And so it was like, all this was going to be the next big thing, you know, and they were throwing everything at it because FX, I think is the channel, really loves, you know, Kurt Sutter. And so, and it read well, like the first script, but there was only one script and I had a nice part and it was going to potentially could let to, you know, like quite a nice couple of years working.
Yeah, a few seasons.
And then of course, so it was hard to schedule both. That was one of the big starting reasons. And also,
isn't it funny how life turns out when you spend so many years trying to get a role and then you're like, oh, I've now got to choose between two great ones.
And it was all, so the scheduling was hard. And also I think they were, the man who took over, Vlad, amazing, lovely. And like the best, one of the best sword stuntmen in the world. Like he's great at sword and horseback. I think he's an amazing horseback rider from what I understand. So it kind of makes sense logically to have a stuntman do what could potentially be a lot of, you know, stunt work as well. Rather than have two people or, you know. So I think the combination of those two things really led to what I've never regretted. Like people think, oh, you were recast. Never. It was not even that at all. It was purely a decision as much on my end. And I'm not regretted because I don't think I could have done 31 even. Like there's a lot because they tie you up a long time, even though they may not be using you. There's potential that, you know, you know, it's Game of Thrones. So
yeah. Oh man, if you'd have missed out on Doomhead.
I would have missed seeing, and it could change my whole life. So you think on one hand, you know, cause I was a bit like, oh, it'd be great if I could do both, make it work, you know, but, and then, you know, this doesn't, you're like, oh, well. And then of course, if I look back, it was in fact pretty much most of the work I've done. Definitely don't think I could have done Three from Hell. So, you know, most of the work, in those years would have been very hard to schedule in as well. So definitely, you know, but I still got to be a part of it and play and do what I think is my favorite scene anyway, Hard Home. So.
Yeah. And did you watch the rest of the show out? Were you invested in it?
No. I don't. Honestly, I didn't. I
was only going to say, because anyone listening to this will go, you have to ask him how he feels about the ending. Because
I did watch last season, weirdly.
So many people jumped in on the ending.
I basically knew what was happening. I would follow it. And, you know, I would follow it plot-wise, and I would find out what's going on, partly because, you know, I'll go to conventions and people ask me. And so I knew what's going on. And I would watch episodes from time to time, and it was because I know all the characters would be easy enough to pick up. And then I watched the last season for a number of reasons, but partly because I was with people that were in it. I was weirdly in the States a lot earlier this year, doing some conventions and some other things, working as well on a film. So I watched last season, this season.
And thoughts?
I mean, honestly,
it got kind of
people
berated,
but people are always, no one's ever going to be happy when something comes to an end.
Yeah.
I mean,
never a true word.
You know, and
it should have been like this. They should have done that.
Yeah, I mean, it's just inevitable. I mean, it was such a. I'm just grateful that they ended it, as opposed to, I mean, they could have easily just milked another 3 years out and it just died a death.
Yeah.
And rather, it was such a good decision to end it in eight years. I think they did, you know, and I was really happy with my ending.
Ari is my favorite
my
character.
My favorite character. Always.
I've got a t-shirt and then I'm going to show you after. It says ACDC, but Arius, A-R-Y-A. And I was overjoyed with the ending because I loved what they did with Sansa and her. And
yeah. I mean, see, again, people don't look at that. I mean, you know, they're all complaining about whatever they're complaining about, but the way they developed her character.
Amazing.
It's genius. Genius.
And I hope she gets her own spin-off. It'd be so cool. I want to talk to you about a couple of the indie films. Then we'll talk about Mandy. And then I guess we'll tease Three from Hell. But so last night I watched two films of yours, which are perhaps lesser known ones. Outpost was the first, which is kind of like a zombie Nazi film, not in the style of Dead Snow. No. It's not like a silly, it's a lot more rooted in science and, you know, kind of horror. And you in that, again, this kind of ex-Marine character, totally fearless, like killing machine, badass. A great death scene once again. Like you've had some great death scenes from Doom to Halloween 2 to that one where you're mauled by zombies. And that cast as well, you've got Michael Smiley.
Yeah, that's great.
An amazing little kind of indie film that obviously, I guess you just filmed in a field somewhere, right?
Oh yeah, like, we did. You did. You know, what's weird about that one is we filmed that, mostly now you'll film in Eastern Europe, a lot of stuff, especially at that kind of budget gets filmed in Eastern Europe. And Eastern Europe doubles for everywhere.
Yeah.
In particular, like all over America, it's Eastern Europe. We're not really America. And that film we shot in Scotland, doubling for Eastern Europe. So it's weird. It's backwards.
I was going to say, it's set in Eastern Europe, isn't it? But it's filmed in Scotland. Brilliant.
We shot it in Scotland. And it was great fun. I mean, I met Michael then. And, it was a bunch of guys hanging out in Scotland making a movie for a month.
You got some great dialogue in that as well.
Yeah, it was some weird because I was having this weird Steve McQueen obsession at the time. He's a great actor, right? Steve McQueen.
He's amazing.
A lot of people sort of think, Steve McQueen, he's known for like just being iconic as a human being. But if you watch him as an actor, he's incredible. And he doesn't, what's so great is somebody told me he used to go in and like just cut all his dialogue because he thinks you could just do it with a look. The way he listens to the other actors, you can just see so much listening to them and just doesn't need to speak half the time. So I had this whole like obsession with Steve McQueen. I call that my Steve McQueen performance because I was just reading everything about watching every one of his films, really just analyzing Steve McQueen for some reason. And I would go and I would be like, no, we can cut those lines. So I used to cut like half the lines sometimes. But, it did pay off because I really wanted...
It makes him a bit more mysterious, doesn't it?
Yeah, I wanted him to be just a man of few words, really. And he's actually a good guy for the first time, like I'm playing. I mean, he's a hard ass, but he's not a bad guy. And I just wanted him to be just a man who, when he spoke, there was a reason. And it was just fun to play that kind of just tough, just full Marine. And,
what's wrong with you? You look like you fucked your sister. Great lines. Yeah. And then the other one I watched is The Incident, which sort of, I guess, must have been almost like a preschool for Game of Thrones because your character in that film has not a single word of dialogue in the whole film. And he's basically this kind of crazed lunatic that it's implied, it's never explicitly revealed or, resolved, but it's implied that he's behind this kind of riot in this asylum.
Yeah.
And he gets all the inmates to stop taking their medicine and rise up and madness ensues. And he kind of just... like a specter floats around and crops up.
That was fun. That was shot in Belgium. And it was weird because I thought it was going to be challenging. No dialogue. And he's meant to be basically the force behind it all, like you said. And I forget, I was filming something else before in America. So I had to fly there. And I hadn't done a lot of preparation, but I had this one thing where I thought, he's obsessed with like worms. I made it up because I had to work out what this guy's issues were. And that the worms are inside of people's mouths. So there's like one scene where I have to like dig inside someone's, like the leads guy's mouth and look, and I'm looking for, and that's all me. I actually decided to start digging in his mouth and doing all that weird shit and stuff just to figure it out. But it was definitely challenging. I'll tell you what was particularly challenging on that film is I put my back out for the first time in my life, seriously badly. So there are scenes in that where they literally had to like force me into position. And I'm in agony while I'm going through it and stuff, because for some reason it just seized up then. And it's never been as bad since, never. But that one particular film. So I always remember it as the one where I spent most of the time on my back, and then they'd bring me in, and I was just like, oh, okay. But I made it. It's fine.
And what about Mandy? Would you look at that as an indie film?
Yeah.
Because obviously Nick Cage is in it. He's obviously a huge star, but it's very unusual, isn't it?
Oh, yeah. As a film?
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, it's incredibly. I mean, he's a visionary, Panos.
It has that almost Dario Argento.
Yeah.
Italian horror feel, yeah, with the colors and.
Yeah. But with crazy mad bikers from hell.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. No, it's. I mean, people. I mean, it's gotten incredible reviews.
It's an amazing film. If no one's seen it, I strongly recommend it.
Oh yeah, 100%.
It's Nick Cage in some of his most possessed and demonic and finest work. Like with that scene when he's drinking the straight vodka and like yelling and screaming. And the guy we mentioned earlier, Linus Roach.
Yeah.
There's Jeremiah. Is it this kind of cult leader?
And that was a great casting move, because you know I not thought of Linus in a role like that. And they put him in. It was brilliant.
And then you play the chemist. Just one scene. You, Nick Cage, and a tiger.
The weird, it was the weirdest thing. Because that basically, I got my agent call me up and said, you know, oh, casting Nicolas Cage movie. And like, oh, whatever. Sent me the script. And like, sometimes I'll get now, you know, shooting in wherever. That was Belgium too. And because of some of the work I've done around like 31 and things, there's a point where I get sent sort of bored horror type films.
Yeah.
And I'm like, I really got to audition. And it's not a big part of it. I'm like, really? You know, I'm a bit like, you can make me go audition for it. Jesus, when am I not going to have to audition for this? Right. So it was a bit like, sometimes I'll say, I'm just not going to audition. If they send them my reel, they have a look, cause then they might be interested. But, so I was about to do that, and then sent me the script and I read it, and I was like, oh, it's really crazy. This is quite unique. And then they asked me to read for two parts. One was the chemist, and one was the part that Ned Denhe played, which is the assistant to Jeremiah's sidekick. And I was like, Jeremiah's sidekick's in the film a lot. So at the time I wasn't working. It was summertime and I hadn't got a job yet. And I was like, oh, that's going to be like six weeks work, man. That'd be good money. The other one day, but I read it.
Literally one day.
Yeah. And I read it and I go, I know which one I'm getting, because I couldn't, because why Ned's so brilliant too, because when I read it, I thought that character was a bit kind of dull, and Ned really makes it a great, like he does a great job. I mean, that character is memorable. I mean, I don't know. When I saw it, I couldn't work out how to do it. How to make anything of it. So when I did the chemist audition, I just took my shirt off, had all these tattoos on my back, and I just did this weird like an audition. And 2 hours later, I got the job. And I was like, that's the fastest that I've ever got a job. But Panos had seen 31, so he already had known me. And then I was like, oh, okay, good. So I had done, so then I got that. And it was honestly the most fun I've had in a long time. And Nicolas Cage.
Because of working with him?
Partly that and partly Panos, because he's so out there, you know. He's just incredibly creative as well. And him and Rob really he reminds me a lot of Rob in that way. In fact, they met recently, so I got a text from Rob with a picture of the two of them having like 20 espressos each talking for ages. So they have a similar kind of creative huge creative well basically inside them. And he just, you know, he just let me just ad libbed all kinds of stuff. And Nicolas Cage, again, I was like, how's he going to be? Because he's Nicolas Cage. I mean, he's just an icon. Is he going to be difficult? Amazing. Really. I've only worked with him one night, actually, it was. But he doesn't speak. So he could
literally not be there, right? The
when I'm doing my whole speech, some actors would just, of his stature, would just not even bother. They would just, you know, put one of the runners in there, and Nicolas Cage just sit, you know, smoking dope or whatever. I don't say he smokes dope, but would be sitting in his trailer, relaxing, you know, watching TV or something. And he stood there the whole time and literally was just like completely present the whole time I'm doing my thing, like really with me in the whole scene. I was like, wow. I mean, there's no need for him to do that, because his camera ain't on him, it's on me. So I was beyond impressed with that. And he's just a nice guy, lovely guy. And his performance is incredible. I mean, they're all saying it's his like best performance.
Probably since leaving Las Vegas, yeah. I'd say.
Honestly, the reviews were incredible. Which, you know, it's just a shame because it only didn't get any theatrical release. You know, it just shows you went to Sundance, amazing reviews of Sundance. You know, all this hype about this Nick's best film, all this stuff, you know, gets more great reviews and then has to go, unfortunately, no theatrical release or very limited if it had one. Shows you how hard today it is to get indie films in theaters. I mean, if that can't get in theaters.
I know, right?
Oof. You know, I mean, it's Nicolas Cage, best performance ever, rave reviews of Sundance, and, you know, shows at Six Cinemas or whatever. You know, it doesn't hold much hope for, you know, the indie films.
Well, it used to be like straight to DVD as well, but now because DVD sales aren't even really a thing,
yeah,
it's like, unless you're on Netflix, where are you going to go?
Yeah.
That leads us in perfectly to talk about, I guess, what would be your first lead role? Would you be right in saying that? Perfect Skin?
Yeah.
Like, full on, you're the lead, front and center. And it's set in London. Is it filmed in London?
Yeah.
Yeah. Is it a British filmmaker?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. So it's an entirely British film.
Yeah, totally. 100%.
And you play this kind of, well, it's not the typical Richard Brake warped, deranged, over the top. Like, it's a very normal, grounded guy, and he's a tattoo artist, and there is the girl Eastern European?
She's from Poland.
And she comes to stay with an Australian because she's basically just got nowhere to go, and then they meet this tattoo artist played by you, and the Australian girl has to leave London to go visit her parents, and then without giving too much away, you kind of start doing stuff.
I would say basically I kidnap a girl and tattoo her entire body, then hang her from the ceiling.
There you go.
Yeah. But
and it's a real delve into a world which undoubtedly exists. Like, I've got a lot of friends who are tattoo artists, and they're normal, but there's dark characters in that world, and it attracts a certain type of person, I think, as well, the more extreme end of bodification.
Yeah, probably. I mean, I think with the character's name Bob, I think with Bob, because like you said, I didn't want him to be psychotic.
Yeah.
You know, and I neither did Kevin, you know, who's another great director too. And that was his first feature, I'm pretty sure. One of the things was that he not just be a nut, because I didn't want to do another Nutcase. I'd done 31, and that was, you know, at that point was coming out, I think, while we were filming this. And I just, another psycho, just crazy guy. But what was great about Bob is that he's pushed because he's basically ill and he's losing. Well, it's about really about a man losing his art, and he's trying to hold on to his art. I remember when I was in school that my teacher once said the reason he thought that Ernest Hemingway had shot himself was because he, and later in life, was no longer able to write as well as he could in younger, and his writing was how he kept his world together. Yeah. Writing was how he kept his mind together. Yeah. In other words, as his talent began to deteriorate, he was sort of losing his one thing that he had, and so he just knew he was losing it, so he killed himself. That's his theory, right? I'm not saying that. I mean, the Hemingway
scholars
might be. It makes
sense though, right? When you lose your gift, your calling, you feel lost and adrift, and he's like losing his family
that's
as
what's
well,
happening.
Isn't it?
Exactly. And so it's a man like that. It's not just a nutcase, right? I mean, I played a psychotic this summer in a TV series, like a pure psychotic, like a psycho. And that was really interesting to play. And it's very specific dynamics to those people, psychotics. But this guy is not that. You know, he's social. He has empathetic. You know,
he's charming.
Yeah. You know, so are psychotics, but like Ted Bundy was incredibly charming. But
he's
charming in a way that he is empathetic. You know, he's got empathy. He does care, Bob. But Bob is just, and he becomes more and more obsessed. And he does flip at the end. I mean, he does go somewhere else eventually. But it was challenging to try and make the audience feel some empathy towards him, or at least feel he's human. And that was what I really wanted. I didn't want to think, oh, it's another crazy Rich Brakes, you know.
And it's your first lead role, you know, you're like, what, 55? It's been a long time coming.
Yeah, Kevin, really, they offered it to me out of the blue. I think, you know, they were looking at somebody else had done a short. He had done a short initially to raise some money. And actually, actor I worked with, Ben Daniels had done the short a couple of years ago. He's Ben's in Doom. Great actor. Great actor. And Ben had done a short they made of this film. And Ben wasn't available because he was, filming something somewhere. And so they offered it to me. And I was like, definitely. I met Kevin. I was like, yeah, absolutely, 100%. Once I realized, and Kevin wanted to make it too, very much like those old British films in the 60s that were, you know, not all just horror, but more
like a Peeping Tom kind of film.
Yeah, exactly, exactly. That was the one that we were talking about when I met him. And to be that kind of more in your head than right up. And, you know, there's a risky, because audiences today want lots of, you know, action, but we really went for that. And I think it delivered. I mean, I wasn't sure it was going to work. I wasn't sure whether I could pull off, you know, whether there was enough in there to make him somewhat empathetic, or whether audiences would go with the kind of British Peep and Tom vibe that it was going to have. But the reaction's been really, really good. It's won quite a lot of awards at different festivals. And
nice. It's available on iTunes as well.
It is. You know, I mean, that's, you know, it doesn't, rented. Unfortunately, there's not big marketing behind it. So really, people, you know, who are looking for something to watch, this is, you know, it's not slash 'em up horror. It's really just very psychological and unnerving. I would love people to see it, because, you know, it doesn't have a big name attached. You know, it doesn't have big money behind it, making you in your face all the time, so you can't, you know, bomb bus billboards or whatever, even barely at all. It just sort of pops up on your screen when you're on Now TV or whatever you have. But it is, I'm really proud of that work. I think it's a little chamber piece that, you know, has its own little psychologically bizarre charm. Oh yeah.
And how was it for you getting your teeth into a lead part?
I loved it. I mean, one of the things I loved about having, in a, you know, a lead part, you've got basically so much to work with, which is great. But also, in a way, I felt, because it was very indie, you know, we didn't have trailers or any of that. I mean, it was very indie. It wasn't complete low budget, nothing, but, you know, we had to cut corners, definitely. And everybody was working long hours and really hard, and tattoo stuff was tough to put on people. So there was a lot of, like, anxiety, you know, tension at times, as I can't be on that type of stuff. I really felt the responsibility as the kind of guy who's there every day, who's the lead in film, to really not just, I thought, you know, when I started, I thought my job is not just to do a good performance, but also to kind of bring some, just some creative, and it's just the kind of what Rob does, but just give a bit of inspiration to make people feel good about coming. Maybe want to come to work.
Yeah.
You know, I want to do my bit to make people want to enjoy this experience. And I really enjoyed that. I really felt like, because I think my first day we were shooting, we were late. I think they were late setting it up, or they got us there way too early, like me and Natalia. And I was a bit like, oh, you know, a bit like.
She's
like,
great in it.
She is. And I was a bit grumpy. I was like, oh, why are we here so damn early? And I thought, no, I can't have an attitude like that. You know, I had to say, like, you know, Natalia, it's a long day for her with the, you know, maybe it was better to get her in, you know, I told producers quietly, but. Not, you know, I thought, I'm not going to have any, I'm just going to really try and make it a good, and that's a great, great thing about, I think, when you're leading a film, is to try and also lead the company a bit.
Yeah, you're like the captain, right?
Yeah, a little bit, yeah, or at least like one of the important first mates. The director's probably the captain.
Yeah.
The director's be like, I'm not hiring him.
I'm the captain.
She's great in it, by the way, you're
right.
She's
fantastic.
And, you know, and she's, because a lot of hers is just really tough, she has to react to so much. And she had to go through incredible, man. And she shaved her head for real. I mean, it was incredible.
She has to go to some very dark places psychologically.
She deserves so much credit for that, yeah. Really great work.
Yeah. What can you tell us about Three from Hell?
Not much.
So we can set the scene. It's obviously a sequel to The Devil's Rejects. Yeah. And as well as the original threes, Bill Moseley, Sherry Moon, and Sid Haig, you've also got yourself.
Yeah.
You've got your buddy Jeff Daniel Phillips.
Yeah.
Let's talk about him, working with him on 31, and then, do you get to work with him in Three from Hell, or do you have scenes together?
Yeah.
Tell me about, because he's a good buddy of yours, right?
Really good buddy. Yeah, I love Jeff. Just texted me a minute ago. He said, because we've got a little project working on. He said, you can say a little bit, be vague. he's another incredibly talented guy. He directs as well. He directed a film quite a few years back, and writes. And also he's one of the sweetest people, really. And this, in especially in this business, you run into a lot of people that maybe aren't so sweet, and are a bit egomaniacs or narcissism or all kinds of stuff. And he's just the loveliest guy. You can see why. I mean, he's not the fact that he's just a great actor and why Rob uses him, but he's just a great guy to have when you're working beside you for many reasons. And he brings so much to stuff. And we met actually at the Halloween 2, because we're both in that. He plays two parts in Halloween 2. At the premiere for that, and just hit it off there, just at a premiere, which, you know, rarely happens. And then we just kind of vaguely stayed in touch. And then on 31, we just had a blast and became really close. And now, Three from Hell, we had another blast, which was just, you know, working. I mean, it's like the, when you work with Rob, it's honestly like working with the family.
Really, he has like those recurring cast members.
And the crew as well, you know, and the producer, like I said, Mike, and all of us, you know, you see so many people you worked with, you know, before, and just those guys. I remember because I was doing a feedback of film with Eddie Marsan, actually, in Spain, and I had to literally fly straight to L.A. to begin work on Three from Hell. And it was so, I just literally landed. I was in and out from just finishing one thing. And I went there and walked in, and they'd already started, actually, and came in, and they were all at lunch. And it was just like, wow, being home. And I saw Sherry, and then a big hug. And everybody. It was an incredible feeling when you're working with Rob and the whole group of us. And Jeff, big part of that. So it's lovely. I mean, when I'm there, I usually stay with him. There's a little room I stay in.
Love it.
Yeah. But what are we saying about Jeff?
You're saying what little you can tell us you're hopefully about to.
Oh, so yeah. So basically they're back. You know, the Firefly clan are back and badder than ever, you know, and just shooting it was great in terms of, you know, we obviously, you know, had a lot more than 31 in terms of just things that are at disposal. And just what can I give away?
The trailer's
out, so they're giving away a bit on the trailer. I mean, you know that they survived.
Does it feel like the culmination of all of Rob's work to date?
I mean, we definitely think it's... I mean, while we were shooting it, all of us like, this is going to be his best film, you know? And
because Devil's Rejects is so good.
Yeah, like, I mean, that's... it is, and people love it, and, you know, there's always going to be, oh, it's the best film ever. You know, you could make, you know, Citizen Kane times 10, and people, some people are just can never accept it, you know? So, it is as it is. But all of us... And I think Rob included just think it's his masterpiece. I think it's his best work, and definitely on the paper, and definitely while we're shooting it. And, you know, and Rob seems he's really excited about it. Been having some texts with him, and he's just very, 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 very pumped. This is definitely going to be his, you know, absolute masterpiece, if not. And then there'll be another great masterpiece after that.
Yeah.
But, you know, this is...
Well, he doesn't mess around, does
he? You're not, I mean, we were just knew when we were filming it, this is just going to be... This is going to be mind-blowing. People are going to totally dig it.
And you've got Danny Trejo in the mix as well.
Yeah, I mean, he's got...
Do you get to do scenes with him? Do you get to work with him?
Yeah, he's great, yeah.
What a character.
Oh, yeah. Saw him recently again at a Comic-Con. He's just such a old school, been around, done so much.
Well, he's like in Mexican jails, right? Like he used to be...
Yeah, he was in jail, I think, and then got up and just cleaned himself up, you know. He's pretty open about the fact that, you know, he's... been clean for a long time from drugs and drink, and he's been a long time, like decades and decades. And just, you know, again, just a great guy. I mean, the thing about, you know, Rob, he doesn't bring, you know, doesn't surround himself with anyone who's an asshole. So everybody there is just really great to be with. But yeah, I mean, can't really give anything away. I wouldn't want to anyway. Nobody wants to know. You want to know what happened. You gotta watch it, man. You know, it's better having the experience than
going dry.
But definitely think it's going to blow your mind. Yeah.
It's been a good ride, hasn't it?
Yeah. Let's hope it continues. I'm going to knock on wood. Because
does it feel like you're just getting started in some ways as well?
Oh, God, yeah, man. I mean, that's the thing with Jeff and I. We're working on a project. I was saying that.
Oh, cool.
Been trying to... Jeff's to direct. He's written it. And we've been... looking hopeful that we've actually finally got our money in place. So I'm hoping to shoot that later in the year. And that, I play a lead again. So, you know, it's tough raising the money when the lead is Richard Brake. It's a lot easier when the lead's Nick Cage. But, you know, we think we have it together, and we're, you know, it's a good little script. It'll be quite another crazy ride. So, you know, there's so many things that I still got to do, still looking forward to. I mean, I love it. Like I said, I still love going out and learning and just doing, you know, things. I mean, and the one with Jeff, you know, I'm probably to do a Welsh, accent.
Really?
Yeah, I got to play a bit guitar. I got to do, you know, this. So it's been a while since I've done this, playing Welsh the whole way through. Should we call it Welsh accent the whole way through? I got, you had Kelly Jones, I think.
Yes.
I was listening to that yesterday, just a bit of that. He's perfect accent, something like that.
Nice and soft.
Soft, beautiful. Yeah. So I'm like, I'll be listening to that. I'll copying him the whole
right
time.
Right on. He's a beautiful guy.
Yeah?
Yeah, really nice guy.
I love Stereophonics, man.
What a voice.
They're great. Oh, amazing voice, right? Amazing.
Yeah. Rich, shake my hand, dude. Honestly, thanks.
Here. I hope we haven't bored the pants off of
they're going to love everyone. It. Thank you so much for coming around to my flat and having a chat and coming on the show. It's been a great honor.
Totally enjoyed it. Thank you so
much. I love your work, man. So long may
it
continue.
Thanks for letting me wrap it up. Thank you, man. Thank you.